The March 7th meeting of the Finance Committee here in South Deerfield, Massachusetts. I think Ralph's going to make a few copies, but we'll get started. I have passed out copies of last week's meeting minutes, and as you guys peruse those for a moment, there's both sides on that. Doug, I have a question for you. The previous week's minutes that we accepted, I had to go back. There was a number not filled in that we went back and filled in.
Okay.
Do we need to revote those, or can those stand as inserted? How does that work?
They should be revoted.
That's what I would think.
Consensus agreement, or are you going to revote it?
Yeah, we can do that.
I just do that. You know,
sure. Okay. I'll wait for Ralph to come back. And it was basically the group insurance number that we voted. There was this discrepancy as to which number it was, and I verified that and dropped that in. But let me know if you guys see anything on this, the Feb 29 meeting minutes.
Oh, guess we're not even keeping them. Yeah. Fin team. I don't know what Fin team is. Oh, finance committee. I'm just losing my mind. You think I'm losing my mind? I would sit like in the conference room if I were you, but I think you need to sit here. Yes. No. I was kidding about it being the hot seat. I was just in the hot seat. You're in the hot seat.
Oh, yeah.
No?
Okay. I thought it was.
All right.
No. That's all. I was like,
good.
How you doing, Kevin?
How you doing tonight?
Doing well.
Excellent.
Well, a couple of quick things to tick off the list, and then we'll turn over to you and go through your budgets.
Perfect.
Hey, I don't...
All right, are you going to go down through the budgets as it is here? If it is, I can just have my stuff paper already lined out that way, so it'll go a little quicker.
Sure, although I gave my copy to Mark, so I don't see that anymore. But yeah, we can do that, and you can lead the charge. All right, perfect.
Front and back on a couple of them.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Dylan, is that the minutes from the 16th?
23rd.
From the 23rd.
You look at 23rd under group insurance in the voted line at the bottom, it says insert amount. Well, I hadn't inserted the amount.
Thank you.
What is this?
Okay, opening it.
Oh, so this is the last couple of years of Deerfield before scams.
Right.
Correct. Gotcha. Okay.
No. Just leave here.
So thank you, Ralph.
Group insurance.
Do you see where I'm talking about, Doug? The one I sent you today has it dropped in, but the one I had sent Barbara initially had it, did not have an amount.
Okay.
Here, let me...
Do you want to revote it?
Yeah, I would just revote it to include the number. Let me just see that we're on the same.
Because I'm just looking at February 23rd. This is a message from... Yeah, today.
Okay, yeah. So under group insurance, it said voted like 820 something something.
Yeah, okay. 820, 532, that's
exactly
the correct number.
That's the revised before it said insert amount, where it said 820.
Okay.
So I'll put it up to revote and you can read that amount and then we can do that.
Sure.
Okay, sorry. So getting started, the first thing I want to do is to revote the Feb 23rd meeting minutes. And what had happened was there was an amount that we voted where on the notes it said insert amount instead of having the amount inserted. So this is the group insurance budget, which we voted an amount, Doug, of?
$820,532.
Okay.
I had one job and I couldn't even get that right. 820,532.
So this is just a vote to amend the 23rd minutes to include that amount, which we did vote, and I will recirculate those meeting minutes as we did the previous time when we had them amended. Anyone have any questions on that? Okay.
So, you want a motion?
That would be great.
I'll move the minutes of whatever the date
23rd.
Is as corrected.
Second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
You were
one abstention.
Not here. Yep. I like the consistency. Abstaining again. All right.
Oh, could you give me that dollar amount?
820-532.
Okay, so moving on to the minutes from the previous meeting last week, Feb 29, that I handed out today. Were there any questions, comments, or corrections on those minutes?
Nope.
I think you did a great job.
Well, Mary helps, Mary puts together a lot of the details, and I just kind of format and...
Well, it's a good team effort.
Yes.
Make a motion, we approve them.
Keep up the good work.
Okay.
I'll second that, John.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. So there's that. All right, let's see here. Okay, there are a few things I would like to tick off. Each of these will not take very long, I don't believe. And then we'll move over to Kevin. The first one is the Finance Committee budget. We had typically had a budget of $250. We had voted maybe a month or two ago to preliminarily increase that because we had some additional expenses in FY15 that came to, I believe, $394. So we looked to increase it to that amount. I basically took a closer look at the last 2 years. It costs $155 to pay the membership to the Finance Committees of America or whatever it is that we belong to, and then it's roughly $50 per person to go to the conference. And so, as we talked about a little bit last week, as I felt this may be a tougher budget year as we get towards the end of it, I felt more comfortable moving forward with a budget of $255 to basically pay our dues, be able to send two people to the conference. If something comes up, then it comes up and we handle it like any other department, you know, might have to. What do you guys think of that?
Sounds good to me.
Makes sense.
Yeah. All right, well then I'd entertain a motion for a revised Finance Committee budget of $255 for FY17.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you.
I'll second it.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, so Doug, and you had that in your sheet, right? 255.
Yep,
so
255.
On the nose. Okay. One other quick thing I wanted to touch on, non-budget, non-vote here, was the elementary school roof project. As we know, the debt exclusion passed, and so one thing we had picked up a month ago or so was a reserve fund transfer request came in for the RDA pink work to, at the time, carry us through, I believe it was March 14th or thereabouts, somewhere in mid-March, for roughly $11,000. Sorry, I don't have these numbers in front of me. We had passed that transfer request. There was another one for $3,875, something like that, to go from that middle of March into early April through the bidding process. And so I just wanted to bring that up again. It does not seem at this point we've been asked to push that forward. The only reason we would need to do it is if it was easier for us to do that, as Barbara's still trying to get all the bands and funding set up that she can now do. So nothing for us to take action on, but we may have to do that in the next couple of weeks. And, you know, certainly if it's the best way to accomplish that, I would support that, and we'll let Barbara and Doug kind of lead us on that. Any questions on that one?
Nope.
Okay. There's that.
This is our real boss here.
Yeah. Yep.
The big, big boss?
What's that? Oh, 6:30.
Okay. I think with that, I will turn it over to Kevin, and we can start in on his budgets, and we'll look to follow the order on the agenda I'd sent around. The first one is town office building management. So if everyone wants to dig out their budgets and or look at what Kevin handed out, let's see.
What's the number on it?
It's on the
5,400.
I've added the accounts to the agendas because I thought that would be helpful. Right. So if anyone has that, yeah, 192,5400. Cool. Now I need to find this.
Kevin, what is the bom line number do you have on that budget?
433,5400. Transfer station?
No, town office building management.
Town office.
He did not just pass this out.
Okay.
He did not pass out every budget. I believe just maybe
but
ones that changed.
The total appropriated was 73.
So they did not bring the...
That's fine. You can look on with me.
Okay, 73070 for total appropriate. Right, okay. That's the total request for FY17.
Again, 192?
Good. We're on the same page. Yep.
Okay.
He's frontwards or backwards?
Front. Right way. There we go.
Yeah, that's okay. It's,
you can stand that way.
All right, Kevin. Town office building maintenance, I see a budget as passed to me of $73,070.
That is correct. Actually, I'll be honest with you, as I was looking into this, I noticed that two of these things were combined on my expenditure report. So actually, you guys want to go down line by line? Is that the way you want to do it? Or How would you like to approach this? So I see two numbers I'd like to change.
Okay. Well, why don't you...
Actually, just one number.
Okay, why don't we start with the changes?
Okay.
And we can go from there.
What number you have?
All right, so it's actually would be your first dollar amount on the right-hand side, the $13,500. That can actually be reduced to $11,200. And that would actually be my only change on this one that I'm looking at right now.
Does everyone have this budget in front of them? We all got it? Okay.
What was that account number again?
It's at 192-5400, Town Office Building Maintenance.
Yeah, well, I've got, you know, oh, there it is. Page before.
I looked down through, he said the first one, 16.
Second one. That number was 13.5, Kevin?
Yes, correct. Was 13.5. I can do 11.2.
You're dropping it to 11.2?
That's correct.
That changes the bottom line, for those of you playing at home, to $70,770. Which represents an increase of about $5,100 over last year.
$70,770.
You press that and you go back to the big detail sheet. Select any one of these budgets.
Anyone have any questions for Kevin on this one?
The only one that I have any questions on is the last item on there in red.
Doug, can you help me out on this one?
I can. Our local PEG access uses a portion of Town Hall. Not only the heat in the wintertime, very little of it, but more importantly, the electricity for the AC. That little room has servers that are running all day long, all night long. It has an air conditioning unit that's on even through the winter to keep the room cool. And so as a result, it was a decision that was made by this office a couple of years ago to take about $100 a month to offset the electric use that the PEG access station uses to help offset the cost in this budget. So that $1,200 in red represents a transfer of money from our PEG access revenues into this budget.
Or a reduction of...
A negative cost, yeah.
It winds up being a deduction or a reduction in the cost. And actually, thinking about it, that number will likely go away because of the way we're handling PEG access in FY17. Previous to this, this is a conversation I wasn't planning to have tonight, but fair enough. Previous to this, PEG access money was received by the town, and it was brought in as a special fund. It never hit the budget. It never hit the spreadsheet. It never went before town meeting. And it was money that basically was used and stored and sent out to the PEG access company. It was under the management of the Board of Selectmen. And they basically said, okay, PEG Access Company, you've submitted your budget to us, we approve of it, and we'll authorize payments out of this fund. The state DOR has mandated that we change the way PEG Access funds are being used, and as a result, you will now see in your revenue line item, I don't know if you have it already, but you will with the next iteration of the budget, you'll see a new revenue line item of $80,000, PEG Access revenues. And since that's coming in as a clean revenue line item, this $1,200 deduction will no longer happen. Because instead of getting the $1,200 as an offset, we're getting $80,000 as an offset in our revenues. So there we are.
So that should go out.
That should go out. I've just killed it out on this budget. So without that $1,200 deduction, your new bottom line number should be 71970.
And if I took it out of last year's budget, then it would be 66,870.
Correct.
Yeah.
So the net difference really winds up being about
$5,100.
Yeah, $5,100.
Doug, may I ask about the town office building alarm system?
I can give you the
I can give you the 30-second elevator speech, and I'll defer to Kevin for more details.
Okay.
We have an alarm system which does not really work, and Kevin has done yeoman's work in coordinating with contractors to get prices for the installation of new equipment, as well as service and maintenance costs for that equipment. That $2,200 would pay for, please correct me if I'm wrong, it'll pay for our annual fees to have somebody monitoring the alarm system 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's actually fairly low. It's about $360
a year. Each side, this side and police department side.
It also pays for the inspections at least once yearly to have somebody come in, look at every single smoke detector, every single sensor, the main panel, take everything out, check it, clean it, put it all back, and test everything.
And certify it.
And certify it as working.
Which is the key. It's certified, which is critical to our occupancy permit, per se, for the town hall.
Correct. By doing this, we may actually be eligible for a deduction on our insurance. We haven't explored that yet, but it's very likely that, a working fire suppression or fire alarm system, that might help us a little bit. And it also, heaven forbid, the worst happens, it might also save somebody's life. So cheap insurance as far as I'm concerned.
So what kind of an alarm system are you proposing to
basically install? Basically, what we're going to be doing is reutilizing the same equipment that we have right now. They have to go around. They have to look at actually our smoke detectors right now. Because I'll be honest with you, most of those smoke detectors are probably at least 15 years old. There's a pretty good chance that they're going to end up having to be replaced too, which is not reflected upon this budget right here. That's going to have to be very special. Hopefully, we'll be able to be move forward, and then we can utilize some of the funds that are available through building maintenance fund, which hopefully is going to stay so we can continue to utilize those monies for the town buildings. What they're going to do is they're going to, the existing panels, they're not going to take them out, they're going to retrofit them. Neither one of them have dialers, neither one of them have the capability of dialing out. The way the system stands right now, when you have a fire or you have an alarm, the strobe light goes off outside. And if somebody's around, that's great. If nobody happens to see it, then it continues to go until somebody sees it. What they're going to do is they're going to hook up, basically it's a radio system. Instead of putting in dialers, which is a lot more expensive, more complicated, they've got a repeater sitting up on top of Toby, which they also go ahead and monitor because they have multiple systems within town. It's Citizens Alarm Company. They're the ones that do Yankee Candle. They do a bunch right here on Elm Street, very local, the hotel, upfront company, very straightforward, honest costs. And again, the prices I got, because of the timing wise, is still technically only a quote. For the simple fact is the time I got that till the time we actually go ahead and do it, that quote's no good. So I'm assuming he's going to, unless something changes dramatically, he will keep it the same. But technically and legally, it is not. The quote is dead 30 days before we vote this.
Okay. So, and so for the $2,200, you have about $360 for the annual.
Yep.
And
each side.
Yeah.
Yep.
And so how much did you break out or estimate the actual installation costs of this project?
I'll be honest with you, I did not bring that with
okay.
me.
But all that, everything's included in the $2,200 to get up, running, and using it?
The $2,200 will cover, hold on a second, 6, 12. The $2,200 is going to cover your monitoring per year and your services per year, your certifications. It is not including the installation.
Okay.
And again, the installation we were trying to get put in through the building maintenance fund, so that way we can actually have this thing up and running before a town meeting, is what we're hoping.
Okay, and what is the quote, or what do we think that the actual installation cost is?
Ballpark off the top of my head, and you have to bear with me because my numbers are really off lately. I'm going to say less than $3,000.
Yeah, it was under $3,000. It was $24,000, $2,600,
yeah,
something
I
like that.
Yeah, I want to say $26,000, but guess high.
Peanuts in the long run, yeah.
Oh, okay, very important project, just trying to get all the, right. the numbers out there.
Yeah.
Now, again, that doesn't include what we have here. So if whatever fails, that has to be replaced, then...
Well, in my experiences, that's where it gets expensive with the security programs of any kind of
right.
installer. Is the annual stuff is reasonable, and right. getting it in is reasonable, but then when things need to be fixed, it can be somewhat costly.
Because it's actually going to be replacements. It's basically what we have in here is we have smoke detectors and heat detectors. Mm-hmm. That's all we have. We have no motion, no nothing else. So realistically, that's all we're working at right now.
Okay. Any other questions on the alarm system line item of this budget?
So is it just smoke? Is it windows or doors or anything?
No, just smoke, just fire only. Oh. If you want security in the building, let me know and I'll price that out too.
No.
Don't we have an alarm on our vault?
Leave the door open, let it break in.
Not that I'm aware of, but that's not necessarily true. So it's something I'm not aware of. If there was one in the past.
Mary, do you recall if there is an alarm on the vault in the office, in the town clerk's office? No?
There's not.
It hasn't been added in the...
Strictly this building.
It's. Correct. I think it's wired for an alarm.
But it was never
added. Nobody ever figured out how to work it. No, I think there's an alarm thing inside the...
Okay.
A lock, knock box or something like that. Okay. Like the fire department has, but...
Right. We can look at it.
Yeah. Yeah, I made sure that it doesn't stay locked from the inside.
Could you explain how you got these numbers for electricity?
Yeah, basically I'm just going off of where I'm running right now. Right now for electricity, I've got like $1,900 left to run me the rest of the year. And that was going off of a $13,800, because that's what I have for numbers here. Your paperwork in front of you says 2016, I had 15,000. Actually, I only got 13,800. So I'm looking at where I'm at, and I believe I'm going to be short.
If there's another.
You only had 13,800?
Two sets.
We've expended 13,800, or?
No, 13,800
was appropriated.
Something
wrong with that then. Okay.
So there's a few things in between.
Now that's the 15 figure, 2015?
No, I'm working presently right now off of current conditions right now.
FY16.
FY16. So that's a $15,000 appropriation, but you only got 13 what?
13,800
is what you're saying was appropriated.
That's what's in the accounting system as having been appropriated. We have to figure out if that's...
And was the entire 65,670, was that appropriate? Or...
Was what? I'm sorry.
What do you have for a total budget appropriation for FY16?
From Brenda's sheets.
65,670.
Yeah, okay. So it's possible, we ran into this earlier today, where it looked as though one particular line item in one of Kevin's budgets was only appropriated at half the level that we had thought it was, but it was actually just split across two separate accounting system line items. The same thing might have happened here. We'll have to look.
Yeah, 13,800 from the town, 1,200 from PEG access. That's 15,000.
Yeah.
That may have been it.
Could be.
Maybe that's what they did.
All right. How did you get the heating to go up from 11.5 to 13.5? I thought the price of gas was stabilizing.
11.2.
Heating by gas.
He's revised that to 11.2, just when we started.
It's been revised.
Where did he do that?
Just when he started talking about this budget.
I'm $300 cheaper than I was on the paper.
He changed that line to 11,200.
11.2 he changed it to.
Again.
Okay. You got $300 in for a water bill. How much water usage do you have?
Well, right now, between the two of them, because the way it's put into the spreadsheets that I get from the accountant is heat and water expended so far was $3,680.21.
For water?
For heat and water.
Heat and water are combined in this. I cannot take it apart because I do not know how she did her paperwork, the accounting. This I'm just going off of exactly how she pays the bills.
Utilities.
This is how I have to trying to figure between this piece of paper and this piece of paper.
So the total was 11.8 then that you
Correct.
Have in that account?
Correct.
Okay.
Right. So basically, I'm $300 less than what I was asking for last year.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, my next question is: after you get to the water bill, then how much do you pay for sewer?
Present right now, town no town buildings have been paying sewer.
Okay, I want to make sure I hear that correctly.
Yep, no town buildings have been paying sewer. Nobody.
And to me, that's a misjustice because...
That is correct, because it's a difference.
That article said that every sewer user would be paying a bill, and to be fair, every sewer user should pay a fair bill.
Correct.
And I'll bring that up with Frontier tomorrow night.
Yep, because the schools aren't paying, the town offices aren't building, senior center, library.
Anyone else? Wastewater treatment plant, of course, wouldn't pay a bill.
That doesn't pay? That's the only ones that I'm aware of.
The garage?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, any town building. Yes, correct.
Do we have any other town buildings that we typically don't recognize?
None that would have sewer, as far as I can think of.
Or that would have water, therefore.
School, library, senior center, town hall, highway, wastewater, the other wastewater.
Yeah, the two wastewaters.
That's it.
I think that's it.
Right. Yeah, I can't, I don't.
They don't use water at the pumping station, do they?
No.
Okay. Yeah, that's it.
Okay. Could you talk a little bit about the next line item, the custodial services, just kind of what that covers?
Basically, it's a gentleman that, or it's actually, it's a company that comes in, they come through, they clean this building, and they clean the police department, and they also clean the senior center. And I was so informed that they were raising their rates ever so slightly. So they've gone up $1,500 since last year. They've been $19,000 for the past 3 years. So they decided they were going to go ahead and put an escalator in.
So if there's an issue with that maintenance, does that get back to you, or who talks to that firm?
It would probably go through me, or probably go through Doug.
Okay. Yeah.
But there is a channel. So
correct.
Correct.
This is also a contract which I think we need to renew, which probably means we're going to be reissuing a request for proposals or an invitation to bid. So having a little bit of extra cushion there is a good thing, because we don't know what the bids will come in as. It could be that this one company may rebid, but they may only be, and they may be the only bidder, which is great, but they may also come in with a bid that's $24,000, in which case that's what we get.
Or you rebid it.
You can kick it out and rebid it. We could hire a part-time employee. The number of different options for the town to do.
What's the number of hours that we have someone in here?
I honestly don't know.
You have no.
I have no idea.
In town hall, twice a week, 2 to 3 hours each time. Police department is probably about an hour twice a week. I'd be willing to bet it's similar levels at the senior center and at the library as well. So it's 14, 15, 16 hours per week, maybe a little more, maybe 18 per week.
But they also have...
Does the senior center pay for their own?
Doing the floors and the windows, too.
Yes, they do floors and windows a couple times a year. The senior center does not pay for their own. This covers everything.
Okay.
Kevin, the next line, the town office building repairs.
Yep.
Could you?
Sure, building repairs. Actually, right now it's at $10,000, and to be honest with you, that's short money. Really need more money than that if you want to truly do the things that need to be done here. Within this facility, within the senior centers, within the little bit that we do over at the library. Once again, I'm just trying to stay as level funded as possible, going up where I knew we had to go up, just because life happens and the rest of the world go ahead and raises their rates for the things that they do. So I'm just trying to accommodate that. And realistically, the rest of it, I'm just trying to stay even or just a little above. But the long and the short, when it comes to the repairs, once again, it's these two doors over here don't meet code. These two doors over there don't meet code. The crash bars are illegal. The doors are falling off the hinges. The heating system is better than it was, but it's 1971 era. The controls within the system is been worked on. Is it perfect? Certainly not. I mean, it's an older building and needs lots of maintenance. And to be honest with you, to be able to try and keep these buildings up and running for $10,000 a year, I think is fairly cheap money. Personal opinion.
Thank you.
Certainly.
This building, which is the major building, what's its useful life expectancy? Do we have any rough?
I can't tell you. I mean, let me put it this way: you go out, you buy a beat up truck,
right?
You fix it. You can run it for 100,000 miles. It breaks, you fix it, you can run it for 100,000 miles. I mean, I honestly can't tell you how long this building would be good for. I mean, it depends on how you want to go to. Are you looking at, you know, getting super serious about energy efficient windows? Are you looking at changing up, you know, putting up a false ceiling here, creating a lower heating area? All depends on what you want to do with the building. Honestly, can I tell you how long this building is going to last? If you kept up with the maintenance, it'd last forever. But if you do nothing with it, it could fall apart in 20 years, 10 years. I honestly don't know. So,
but there's no reason to think we would need to replace this building in the next 10 years.
No.
We may need to start replacing it at some point in time. But
yeah, you want to start thinking about it. So that way you're prepared
for it. That's
really
what I was getting at.
But no, I don't see a reason why we can't. But again, you know, it's the older the vehicle, the more money you put in. The older the building, the more money you're going to put in. It all depends on how much money you want to put in. You know, if it's good money after good money, that's fine. But if it's good money after bad money or bad timing, then it's a waste of money and you might as well just burn it. So,
Kevin, what's the difference between miscellaneous repairs and department repairs?
I don't know, to be honest with you. I just what I try and do is, if it's for a particular department area, we go ahead and utilize that for their area, quote unquote. If not, because like this area right here would be considered miscellaneous, and like the boiler room, the bathrooms, and stuff like that. I'm not the one that set this up, so I'm just trying to go line by line as how they laid it out for me.
Is it fair that you'd think about those fairly interchangeably, though, that those two combine? I think it's 16,000 is kind of your maintenance repair budget?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah.
What do you do for ground maintenance?
Ground maintenance is basically when historically, in the past, they've utilized an outside contractor to come in and take care of all the leaves during the whatever holiday that is in the fall time. They come through and they vacuum all up.
What now, is that just for this, or does that include the senior center?
Correct. I don't want to say that.
Senior center
sure.
had money in their budget for that. That's why I'm asking.
I do not believe that included the senior center.
They had University of Mass people down doing it this year.
Really?
And just from last year, I'm already overspent. Not by much. $7.75, but...
Lawn mowing, is that in this budget someplace?
I'm sorry?
Mowing of the lawn, or...
We take care of the lawn and stuff.
Okay.
At the town hall?
At the town hall.
How about the senior
center? Senior center, no.
No, and the library, no.
Library, no. All the cemeteries, which we have... We got, what, 8?
You do or don't?
We do.
So
cemeteries, we do.
What? I have to ask this. What's the logic of not doing a library in the senior center?
It's again. This is how it's been. Yeah. It's been pulled into me. So
would they bury you if they were thrown in there?
Probably. I mean, it all depends on the growing season. I mean, last year wasn't too bad. The year before, I lost 3 guys to mowing 4 days a week, just to take care of this. In the cemeteries, which made it extremely difficult to get anything else done in town.
So if we had a rapid growth season, are there any programs where we could bring in summer help? I mean, just like a college kid for the summer? Would that help you out?
So it helped me out dramatically.
Yeah, so you could put people on equipment rather than...
Maybe it's something to think about, trying to consolidate some things, but giving you the, you know.
My understanding is one point in time they had like a youth system or something. I saw something fly by the other day, and I thought I caught wind of it, and I'm trying to get a little information on it, but I'm not really sure. My understanding is what I was told was like 4 or 5 years ago. Now, whether they still do that or not, I don't know.
I think we could. If we could look at that. I mean, I hate to pull a guy who's qualified to be on a piece of equipment in the summer doing road work.
Agreed.
To mow.
If I may, could I ask a question? And I don't mean to get too deep into the details or too thick into the weeds, but...
No pun intended.
What is the... Yeah, right. What is the largest piece of equipment that you would allow someone, say a high school or college student, to operate?
They could use a zero turn.
Zero turn?
Yeah. But so they would have to be at least 18.
Okay. So if there's an 18-year-old out there willing to work for the summer to do just lawn mowing, that would be okay with you?
That'd be phenomenal with me. We'd still have to transport them from place to place to
If the guy's licensed, you could.
Exactly.
I mean, they should have a license as well.
License to drive.
Point.
Might have to teach him how to back a trailer up.
Might have to.
Or just don't put it in any place where you have to back
exactly.
out.
Exactly. Drive in, drive out.
That's right.
Well, we'd like to encourage you to think about that if it's tying up a guy at a equipment operator.
Oh, I'd absolutely love to.
I can work with you.
We also have to think about the liability to the town, the insurance, on top of an hourly rate. So
sometimes there are youth programs out there that might even pick up some of that. I don't know.
But the question is at what point in time do you have to start worrying about benefits?
More than 19 hours a week for more than 3 months consecutive.
And what's the deal with unemployment?
Unemployment, if it's a short-term temporary position, I don't think unemployment comes into play.
Okay.
I could be wrong about that.
Those are the questions I knew were going to be asked at some point in time. So I'd ask
if you're hiring someone from June 15th through September 1st?
10 weeks type thing.
10 weeks type thing, right, exactly. We'd need to confirm all that information with Barbara, but it could work.
It seems like a few years ago there was someone tied to Frontier that was trying to run a program to get high school kids hired out for odd jobs in the summer. I don't
Great.
Know.
High school's tough because so many kids, the only people who are, the only youngsters who are likely to qualify are graduating seniors.
That's true.
That's all you need.
But if they were trying to do it for all high school kids or something.
Well, if Kevin were able to this summer find someone that could work, even in sort of a pilot, program, even if it's not a full 10 weeks, you know, it's certainly something we could look at next year expanding, or that's where you start having conversations about having him handle some of these other buildings if there is the manpower to do it. For purposes of this budget, I think we kind of are where we are in terms of the resources he's going to need and the scope of the work that he's being asked to do. So I feel pretty comfortable with that grounds maintenance line item at this point. And the town clock line item?
Building over there, it's got a town clock, and we pay for somebody to come in twice a year to make sure it's accurate, change the time, and make sure it's running correctly. And that's about all I can tell you.
That's about all you can say about that. That's it.
In every town meeting, they bring it up.
I know.
They do.
That's the funniest thing.
It used to have its own little item, line item.
I mean, because so far, the spring or fall behind was $694.70. So hopefully the spring forward is not more than $575.30.
Where is the clock?
Because that's all I got left.
You want to be able to spring forward like 45 minutes because we ran out of money?
Maybe.
Have a shell at church.
Throw a rope up, change the numbers ourselves.
Can you explain that?
Okay.
There was a lot of support for that clock when we went over this few years ago.
I can understand that church.
Okay, anyone else have questions pertaining to the line items within this budget or the overall scope of this budget? And then, Kevin, do you have any other bigger picture things you want us to think about with regards to this budget?
This budget, no.
Yeah.
Others. The only thing you may want to do, and again, this is extremely difficult to do, especially when money's tight year after year after year. Collectively, we as a town, we as committees, we as department heads have to think about seriously taking a little bit of money and putting it off to a side someplace for different projects, whether it be the new town hall. If we're going to say we're going to do something in 10 years, you know what? Let's start building some money now, because then that way it's going to be a 3.5, 10.9, $42.6 million building. If you got a little bit of kitty money ahead of time, you can help offset a lot of costs. We'll talk later about that when we talk about sewer.
Sure. That's just a warm-up.
Yeah. Okay. But I noticed it's not on tonight, so.
Yeah. So, you know, looking at this budget, so our revised number, we had 71,970. Is that what everybody else has?
Yes, 71,970.
And when I look at that compared to last year, so if you kind of strip out the PEG access, which we're taking out of this year, then last year would have been 66,870. So we're talking about, you know, a $5,100 increase, which is certainly a little bit more in terms of percentages than I think we're looking for in most budgets. Mm-hmm. You know, that said, I think that building maintenance and spending money now to save money later is certainly a priority for us. So how do people feel about this being a budget that has a little bit higher percentage increase year over year?
Well, I agree with Kevin. If we don't maintain our buildings, we're going to lose them. So a little bit of money spent now is probably well worth it.
As long as we've got it.
Hmm? As long as we have it. Yes.
We still run into that problem with the revenues. Revenues don't grow.
See, now this is over. Can we put this 200%. On hold and come back to visit it? Yeah, you know, I hear the maintenance, and I agree with Kevin. There's no question about it, but it's just because of the percentage being mm-hmm. being up there.
I guess if it's subject to us being able to get the rest of the budget together, I'd rather vote it and come back to budgets if we need to when the budget is, okay, let's say, not working. Mm-hmm. If it's particular to some of the items in this, then I would rather hold it. So depending on where people stand, you know, I'd take it one way or the other.
I'd rather move the budget and get it off the table, and if we have to, we can revisit it later.
Yeah, I think pretty much all of these that we're voting are tentative.
True.
Based on our ability to fund entire budget.
Yep. Right. Okay.
So I'll move the budget to $71,970.
I'll second it.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. All right, the next one on the list, Highway Department salary. That is 422,5110 is the number on the account. And Kevin, is this one you had handed out just now?
Yep.
That one there you should have had beforehand, the one that had some changes in it were the general highway expense, which is your next one item.
Wait, I'm sorry, going to general highway expense instead of salary?
Okay, yeah, so this is not changed from previous iterations we've seen. The total number I see is 432,647, increase of 1.68% from previous year.
What's that budget number again?
422,5110. It was one that handed out, 5110.
And this was in the packet he just handed out.
Okay.
I guess, Kevin, if you want to give us a quick overview of any staffing changes or needs or things that you see, again, kind of top down.
Well, basically, the way we stand right now, 8 employees, including myself, 4 of them right now are at step 10 plus. So those people, for calculation reasons, we put in a 1.7% increase. Mm-hmm. And then the other 4 are just a standard step increase.
And any changes to the offsets at the bottom in terms of the approach? I know the numbers are a little different, but kind of anything for us to see there?
I'm sorry, I'm not sure which part you're talking about.
The wastewater treatment plant offsets at the bottom, the negative numbers?
Yeah, they help offset because there is money that's transferred over. Mm-hmm. Because if we are working wastewater, if we're working on the sewer lines, we're billing against wastewater treatment. So the town is not paying for the sewer.
Okay.
It'd be the users that make the money to. And these are basic hours. These are rough estimates that we put in. You know, the hours that going against the hourly rate, basically we do a 2088 for the hours. And then on standard, we do 235 hours overtime. Again, that's just been a standard number they've used over multiple years that has seemed to work.
Any questions from anyone on this one?
Just the on-call mechanic.
I don't know. I didn't put in for it. I haven't for the past 2 years.
Right.
Last 3 years, sorry. I have no idea what that was.
How many, this is just the highway department, doesn't include wastewater treatment?
That's correct, completely separate entity.
Doesn't include the, okay. So, you get a superintendent.
Yep.
You. It's my understanding we had two foremen. Do
correct.
We have two?
Foreman and the other, one of the foremen worked basically highway, and the second person is the one that's taking care of all your facilities.
And where's the second foreman on this?
Second foreman is actually the first one you see that doesn't have a name to it.
Okay. Where's the second one?
The second one is Mike Phillips.
Okay, so it's he's not listed as foreman.
He should be listed as foreman.
Okay.
He should be listed as foreman.
That's just an error in the...
All right. I kind of thought
you're
that.
Right. I did miss that.
The hourly rate on... What's the hourly rate on G3 and G2 step 10? Out of curiosity, not the 10 plus, but just step 10. Does anybody have
hourly
that?
Hourly rate on G3 step 10?
G2 step 10 and G3 step 10.
Give me 1 second, I'll tell you.
Okay.
I apologize for taking so long. G2 step 10, 2163. G3 step 10, 2404.
So G2 step 10 is 20?
21 decimal 63.
63. Okay. And the?
G3 step 10, 24 decimal 04.
Okay. So let me ask the question then. Are these hourly rates accurate?
The 27 decimal 35 for Mike Phillips. And the 21 decimal 63 for Helstowski, yes.
For example, I've got on step G2, Willer, C. Willer, 2118, and you're saying 2163. That was my question.
I'm sorry, so Willer, G2 step 10 plus 2118. Okay, no, I apologize. I think that might be an error. I'm not sure why.
You're supposed to be step 6.
Shoot. Excuse me a second. I'll
find that
out.
Because he's in a new position.
Kevin, help me out on that.
Which one? Doug, I think he's in a different position.
I don't have the spreadsheet in front of me, so I can't.
Oh, I apologize. All right.
Next.
Oh, no.
G3. Maybe not.
For some reason, for FY16, I've got Willer at G3 step 6. Does that sound right?
No.
Okay. Then that's completely inaccurate.
Any difference between a heavy equipment operator and an equipment operator?
Shoot.
Not really. I mean, pretty much everybody runs the same piece of equipment. You need to stay versatile. I assume not have.
But I was going to say, we've got two people here listed as equipment operators and four people or whatever, five listed as heavy equipment operators.
G9, so he should be at G2 now.
Well, my general understanding is your regular standard equipment operator. Let's see. Hold on a second.
They're all
G2s.
They're all G2s.
Mm-hmm.
It was in termination of how when they redid their job descriptions. I don't know. It's, the terminology here was what was set forth to me.
Could we get some clarification someplace on those, Doug?
Sorry, give me one quick second. I'm trying to tweak up the...
Not right now, but...
Okay.
It's almost looking like the way I'm looking at it right now. Originally, back then, because Miller and Chiz were both here for a long time. When they first started, they were probably considered equipment operators, and then they actually changed the name to heavy equipment operator. Assumption. I don't know, because I'm just looking at the people, the newer people. The new people have heavy in front of them.
Mm-hmm.
And the two older ones don't. Purely speculation. Yeah. Again, I don't know. It's
In terms of, I apologize if I'm about three steps behind. In terms of Willer, I believe he for FY16, he was at G2 step 9. So I've corrected his grade and step to be G2 step 10 or 2163.
But he wouldn't be step 10 plus.
He would not be step 10 plus. I don't believe so. We're going to have to look at this tomorrow to be sure.
Okay. So.
So that rate should be.
Could we get updated totals for this particular account for the next meeting?
Certainly.
At least there's enough questions in there that.
Sure. So I agree with Skip that we will hold on voting this until we get a affirmation of what step and rate the one item we've been talking about is going to be, and then maybe some explanation and or a consistency or an ability for this to change in concert between the town office and Kevin and the personnel board of what these descriptions would be so they line up with what we need them to be.
Did you catch that, Doug, when they were, I think you were busy.
I was trying to figure out a number.
Yeah, equipment operator versus heavy equipment operator. And Kevin seems to think they all should be heavy equipment operator.
I think that's actually what we're operating on is that they're all there's basically three types of individuals in the highway department. The heavy equipment operator, the foreman, and then the superintendent.
Yeah. She just but there's says two of them that say just equipment operator.
Right, and that may have been either left over from 3, 4, 5 year ago budgets. Yeah.
That's what he said. All I'm trying to say is I didn't know if you caught it and whether you want to take a look at
such. We will take a look at that. I will work with Kevin and we'll confirm that for the next meeting.
So if is there a slot in your in this for a new hire that obviously isn't a heavy equipment operator yet?
No. I believe it's a typo, to be honest with you. As far as I know, everybody's a heavy equipment operator. The last set of, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mary, if you do remember, when we sent through all of our...
job descriptions.
Yeah, we went through all of our job descriptions. My understanding is everything there. Those guys said heavy equipment operator, but...
So does that mean that...
So this right here could be wrong, is what we're saying, and we're going to look at it tomorrow.
Okay. Does that mean a new hire will not be hired unless they're a qualified equipment operator?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of the presence now. If you don't have the licenses, I can't use you.
Right. Okay.
So.
Okay. That was a discussion a couple of years back where the question arose, you know, what's the lowest position in the highway department? And technically, there is a job description for a laborer, which doesn't have the requirements for licenses except for a standard driver's license. But the bottom line is, as Kevin just said, you can't use a person who can only dig ditches.
Good.
Okay, are there any questions about, like, subject to us getting these answers and sorted out on the naming conventions, does anyone else have any questions or issues with this budget they'd like to ask Kevin about while he's here?
Nope.
Okay, otherwise we'll move on. We'll pass over this until we get those things sorted out.
Good question.
Yeah, sure.
So we're going to be looking at the terminology of the position.
Position naming and then
correction of the hourly rate as it's
written. Hourly rate and step.
Verifying Willer's step and rate and verifying correct and consistent position naming for everybody.
Okay, cool.
And Mary, are you taking notes now? I started in the beginning, but are you or do you want me?
Bill's taking notes.
Bill's taking notes.
Okay.
I don't want to do that to you, Mary.
You can finish.
Go ahead. All right. Next, we have general highway expense. So just a couple pages behind, and Kevin handed one out. I'm not sure if it's different.
What is the clothing allowance?
Clothing allowance is something that they've always done in the past. They've allowed each employee $250 a year. And back in Sean's time, he instituted being able to utilize uniform service, and that's where the numbers are coming from.
Money was rolling in then.
That one went right over my head because I don't ever remember them having a clothing allowance.
Just slipped it in when Sean was there.
I've been here since 2010, and there's been a clothing allowance. Yep. I can tell you that. I can't tell you what happened before then.
They've always had one.
You know, I don't know.
I've been here a lot longer than him.
I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that every highway department offers some sort of uniform service for their employees.
And sorry if I missed this, but you know, obviously it went up a decent amount in 2016, FY16. So, and the increase from 16 to 17 was what again?
From 16 to 17 went from 4,800 to 5,200.
Yeah.
And it was an increase in because we dropped a person for, well, basically the 2 years. So we're bringing the second person back on. So that's going to increase. Plus, once again, you know, they're like everybody else. They added their increase for the year. So,
is there going to be a cap on this piece of line item? I mean, it's not.
You tell me your finance. I mean,
I don't. Obviously, we want to talk about some of these line items, but at least for me, I can't speak for everyone. I trust you to allocate your resources as you see fit. If you want to take it out of this one or that one, or you want to put it into this one or that one, that's what you do. Mm-hmm. You know, just from the top line, looking at, you know, the revised budget, the 260,900 that was passed out, being up 15%. Obviously, we'll get into some of the reasons why, but obviously, that's a big number at the outset.
Sure, not a problem.
Yep. So I guess, would you like to guide us on which line items, you know, are showing increases and kind of talking us through some, and then we can come in with questions either on those or others?
Sure. All right. So the electricity, once again, because we're still trying to get a handle on where we are with electricity. Give me half a second.
How long have you been in the building now, Kevin?
This April will be a year.
This April will be the first year.
Right. So we're still kind of guessing.
That you're on. You basically got the bills for 7 months or eight right. months out of this fiscal year.
Correct.
What are your totals as of right now?
Right now, I've already expended $9,000, and I've got about $2,500 left, roughly.
So you figure that the $12,000 was fairly accurate for this year?
Yeah, it's going to be close.
Okay.
I'm hoping.
Do we have electric space heaters in some of those offices? Or
no,
nothing.
Just here in this building. No need. We're not there. We're usually out working.
The vehicle maintenance, Kevin, is that for things that aren't under, that are?
Vehicle maintenance, that basically covers any piece of equipment that we have. Oil changes, parts, transmissions, motors, tires, rims, anything to do with equipment. We're just throwing everything, as far as repairs are concerned, excuse me, underneath vehicle maintenance, because we didn't really want to see a breakdown of saying, okay, well, you're only going to spend so much money for small engine. You're only going to spend so much money for this. So this takes care of backpack blowers, tampers,
cylinders, hoses.
Yeah,
injectors.
Anything.
Mm-hmm.
Anything you can possibly think of that goes wrong with a vehicle or a piece of equipment, that's what it all encompasses.
Mm-hmm. Hand tools, Kevin. Could you tell me
sure.
what's involved with those? Or, you know, are we dealing with weed whackers and things of that nature, or just?
I really try to keep the again, when we do a majority of the bigger things, like the weed whackers and the backpack blowers, we try and, once again, try and keep them into the vehicle maintenance.
Okay.
This other lately has been, because our mechanic, he has brought in, I'm going to say probably his toolbox is worth somewhere around $140,000, $150,000. So we're utilizing his tools. And as we break some of his things, we're replacing his things, because it's a lot cheaper to do that than it is to go ahead and purchase all these tools ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing we've gone out and purchasing as far as hand tools, and I would consider it a hand tool, very specifically, we just ended up going out and buying a portable bandsaw. Because we needed one. We tried borrowing one. The one we tried to borrow was broke. And I was like, you know what? We use this enough. You borrow something more than three times, you got to go buy it. So that's what we did. And that was $350 for the bandsaw. Now, could I have gone down to Ocean State Job Lots and bought a cheaper one? Certainly. But then I would be replacing those every 2 years. This one piece of equipment, hopefully, the Milwaukee, is going to last me at least five or six. Minimum. And it's for things like that. But it does include some of the shovels. The shovels do get broke. Rakes. What else? And that's a majority of it.
I guess it's impossible to show it here, but my feeling, having been involved down there with the highway garage project, excuse me, it seems as though that they have done a lot to resurrect equipment, repair equipment, things that weren't done before because of skill and so forth. So a lot of these miscellaneous parts or hand tools probably, I'm surmising, have saved us money on other things that you just can't really list.
Certainly hands down.
Yeah.
No doubt. our mechanic has saved us so much money just from the way that he's able to. If you ever want to buy something, mm-hmm. bring him with you.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, just purchasing alone has been, yeah. But there were so many pieces of equipment that were just left over in the scrap pile and forgotten and rusty. And
he's brought back the license.
Pulled them back out and sawed off half of it and bought a new piece for it and got it working better than it was ever designed to be. And those are real pluses. So.
What are equipment edges?
Equipment edges. Those are the ones that's actually went up dramatically. I asked Chuck, I says, because what was killing me was some of this hardware. The hardware, when we're getting out where we were actually billing towards hardware instead of where it actually should have been, which is snowplows. If we take every single one of our snowplows and we change all of the bolts and all the blades twice in one season, it's actually $8,572.
How long is it?
This year, we squeaked by.
Say that again, because I was trying to look at something else. I didn't catch the first part of what you said.
That's what I thought it was.
Which part? About the edges and
yes.
The...
Starting right there. Edges.
Okay, so from the edges.
Yeah.
If we replace all of the edges and all of the bolts twice...
That's on the blades?
Standard season.
That's
correct.
The snowplow
blade.
That's
on the bottom of the snowplow, okay. The cutting edge. Okay. It's over $8,000. So it's kind of one of those. I didn't want to ask for $8,272.57 because that's what the quote was. I asked for $8,000, and I'm sure there's going to be enough wiggle room in one of these other ones. I'm going to be able to steal from Peter to pay Paul.
So what are you doing with? So if we that would change them twice, roughly $4,000 each time you change them.
Yeah.
So if you change them at the beginning of the season, then at the middle of the season?
Well, we change them when they need to be changed. I mean, we're not going to change them time-wise.
I'm just saying, someplace.
Right. We bring it down to just before it hits the moldboard. Once it hits the moldboard, mm-hmm. you don't want to be digging into that, because if you dig into that, then you're going to need a new moldboard, and you're going to want to buy a new moldboard, you might as well just buy a new plow for the price of it.
Yeah.
So a cutting edge is a cutting edge. You got steel on asphalt. It's going to get worn. Again, I'm just trying to show you true numbers of what they are. You know, if you want, you can go ahead and level fund me, and I can steal from Peter to pay Paul, like it's been done in the past. But I'm trying not to do that.
But if I go look, what I'm trying to get at, Kevin, if I go look at the expenditures,
yep.
then I should see, give or take, approximately $8,000 or negative $6,000 in that line.
But he didn't correct. Plow this year, though.
But, well, okay. But this year we were okay.
No, fine. But other years I would have.
Other years? Yeah.
Actually, you didn't have anything up until so.
Because they were taking it from somewhere else. They were taking it from another line item. One of these line items here, they were taking the money from someplace else. What I'm attempting to do is show you exactly what I'm spending the money on. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to be completely and totally transparent, exactly where everything goes. No smoke, no mirrors. This is what it is. This is what it's going to take, and this is what it's going to cost. And if instead of manipulating monies back and forth between the accounts, again, I'm trying to give you a true picture of exactly what there is.
Very much support that clarity.
Yeah. So that's my main goal. Mm-hmm. And again, when I'm a taxpayer too. I'm not impressed with the numbers I'm looking at, but I'm just telling you, this is what it is. This is what it's going to cost, and then. If we decide not to do it, decide to do something different, that's fine too. Again, I'm showing you, this is what I need to do my job at my present level right now.
if we reduce this, and I'm not, it's by no means this trying to be derogatory or trying to point somebody into a corner, but depending on what gets reduced, depends on what doesn't get done in town. So, like, when you get down further, when you get down to, like, road materials, patch materials, stuff like that, if we cut that, then the roads aren't going to be patched. There's road, there's dirt roads that are not going to be fixed. So,
but with regard
these are
the
numbers I have, this is what I need to keep level service, once again, because the other people that are out there, the people we get our materials from, they raise their prices every year. Our gravel costs more every year. Our washed stone is more every year.
Okay.
Historically, asphalt, maybe this spring when they bid it, it might be lower because of the price of fuel. But are they willing to take the chance on that?
But with regard to, like, the edges, I agree. It's nice to pull that out because there's a lot of taxpayers that may not even know that a plow has an edge on it. They may not understand it wears out, and that depends upon how many storms you have. And they may not understand how expensive they are. So it's kind of nice to pull this out as a line item, as Dylan was agreeing with there, and I do too. It's education to the public that helps to explain this.
What account would you say, or maybe it's multiple, that money had come out of before?
Probably tree. I know tree always took a pounding. seriously. And, you know, did some of it come out of vehicle maintenance in the past? Yeah, probably. You know, could it have come out of projects? You know, once again, you know, it all depended on how the person that was doing the bills, how they coded things. Mm-hmm. When I get a bill, I come in and I look, and all of these line items right here have a number to them. Mm-hmm. And that's what I do, is I look at it and say, this is what it belongs to. This is the line item that I claim. So I write it in. So, and I'm not saying somebody did this, but hypothetically, you go ahead and you look at what you have left over. Well, I only have $3,000 left over, but I have $10,000 I have to spend. So I'm going to split this bill in half. So I'm going to take $3,000 out of this line and $5,000 out of this line, or however they did it.
Mm-hmm.
Again, how they did their accounting before me, I honestly don't know.
So,
but you don't want to do that.
The culvert account, did that come out of Chapter 90 in the past?
Again, I don't know.
Oh.
I honestly don't know.
I know we did some big ones 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah, we got another going on right now, too. Mm-hmm.
All right, well, let's, I guess we're kind of working top to bottom, so why don't we continue? The next one is tree work, as you just mentioned it. I know this is something we've talked about in the past, and there's a decent increase here. What are your thoughts?
So, once again, you know, I'm continually being requested to take down more trees, plant more trees, and I'm running out of money.
And this is hiring out.
This is a combination of hiring out and purchasing, you know, like I would consider like my ropes and stuff like that we have to use for taking down the trees. I consider that part of tree because that's the only place I use that saw, or that's the only place I use that rope. So I consider that all tree stuff. When you bring in the people from the outside, they're $1,200-$1,400 a day, mm-hmm. depending on what they're doing. And again, you know, I'm realistically right now, the phones have been kind of quiet, but come springtime, summertime, fall time, I'll have at least 8 to 10 calls a week. I want my tree down. I don't like how my tree is. Some of these are, you know, are actually rotting and we need to take care of them. And mm-hmm. some of them very, very specific is we're looking for the proper time to take off the one that's just as soon as you go over the dry bridge. Because technically that is ours because it's so close to the roadway, but getting access to it is a mud pit down there. So realistically, we're going to end up having to close down one whole side. Like to do that during the summer when I don't have school traffic. That was kind of my plan. But once again, all over town, you go up hillside, you know, you got all those lines of trees, all those pine trees. Every time it comes down, you know, the heavy winds, those are the ones that are coming down, and those we're responsible for those. And if it's stuff that we can't handle, it's too big, then, or anything that's got to do with wires. One of the things we are looking into is we're trying to get a small bucket truck split between Whately, Sunderland, and Deerfield. We'd also be looking at probably setting in somewhere around $7,000 a piece, and that would get us the unit and approximately $350 a year towards maintenance, and that would give us 35 feet of lift. When I came to work here, what we were doing is anything that you couldn't reach with a pole saw, you were getting into the bucket of the loader, and you're going up 15 feet, and you're utilizing the pole saw from there. Unsafe, not happening on my watch. No way. So it's either you pay for somebody to come in and go in a bucket, or if we can collectively get one of these vehicles that we can share between the three towns, I think that'd be a win-win.
Do you think the town is at a point where there's a lot of cleanup of old trees that just have grown and not been taken care of?
Oh, certainly.
Yeah, and will there be a point in time, if we keep cutting these things down, that this will be more minimized if we don't plant new ones?
Not my lifetime.
Yeah.
I hate to be that way. Realistically, and I
can't... But you know what I'm getting at.
Yeah, I do. We did... This was a question from the select board. It was a few months ago, and I honestly cannot remember what the number was, but I do know that we went through, and I can bring it up to you, because I know it's at my office. How many trees basically we're looking at, how many of them we're going to have to take care of ourselves, how many of them we actually have to rent to bring somebody else in to take care of. Again, arbitrary number was somewhere around $135,000 to $145,000, just to kind of...
It was higher. I remember it being about $200,000.
It was an astronomical amount.
It was high.
Of money. And that's not including planting trees. That's just taking stuff out of...
That's the backlog.
Yeah, this is the backlog. This doesn't include taking out anything that is within our right-of-way. You know, because realistically, if you started going through, because at one point somebody says, well, why don't you just take everything out of your right-of-way out, and then you don't have to worry about it. Once again, that's a lot of money, you know, because it depends on which road you're on, depends on how much of a right-of-way you actually have.
Do we... On the major roads, I'm sure it's not too difficult to find out, but on some of the minor roads, I assume the right-of-ways are almost impossible to figure out what they are.
And that it is extremely difficult, because once again, once you go into the archive book that we have, it's a combination of the archive book that we have, and I look at the GIS,
mm-hmm.
the GIS that shows where the town boundaries are. Mm-hmm. You know, one section of River Road, it's very consistent until you get to this one section and it boxes out, goes out 25 feet, goes 50 feet and boxes back in, and then it goes straight again. I'm looking, there's no water, it's not like there's a culvert there or something. I have absolutely no idea why that one area right there was boxed out. Mm-hmm. But technically, that is the town's property.
So if we have a tree on our property, town property, but there are wires involved, you don't mess with those, right?
No, we can't.
Right. And they got DPW permission to... It's on our electric bills to do all this work they're doing the last 2 years. So
right, and they're out there doing it right now again.
Yeah.
But again, you know, if wires come down, or excuse me, trees come down on wires, the electric company goes down, they shut down the power, and if it's small enough, sometimes they'll take care of it, they'll drop it on the ground, but that's as far as it goes. It gets dropped on the ground, and we take care of the rest. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean it's a town tree. It could very well be a residence tree that's further into theirs, but once it's in the road, it's considered the town's problem.
Are you serious? They just drop it on the road and do their wires?
Pretty much.
They'll pull it off the road.
Yeah. Side of the road,
usually.
Depends.
So to answer my question about the trees and whether we're in a spike or not, financially, I gather what you're saying is this tree budget is going to probably continue somewhere in this category for many, many years.
Yeah. Well, okay. And again, it all depends on what the town would like to do. You know.
Well, I understand. Yeah.
I can be status quo, and we'll continually be behind the ball.
What do you think, if there were no backlog, I know there is, how do you start to think about what the annual amount to keep up with the annual is? And I know that's a really tough thing to, but like even a range, like how do you start to think about what that is? Like, all right, let me put it this way. If the number is 36, how much are we catching up on the backlog, do you think?
We're picking up quite a bit because, like I said, a lot of the stuff is the bigger stuff that we can't touch because it's too close to either a house or it's like right next to the power lines. And those are the bigger ones that we have issues with. You know, if it's someplace we can go ahead and drop it and do it ourselves, we certainly do it. The 36, how much more could I be picking up?
Like how much are you taking off the backlog at 36, do you think?
Well, hopefully at 36, you know, I can keep these people in here for a while. I should be able to take a hell of a backlog off of it. I mean, percentage-wise, I don't want to say because...
I know it's hard.
As soon as I say something, I say, well, you said on TV it's going to be 15%, so I'm okay. Not...
But you're getting to the point, Dylan, that I was driving at that, you know,
we'll be a norm. We'll gain a little bit, but we haven't planted but probably 5 trees in the past 3 years. And we're supposed to be planting trees.
And how would you cuff the expense? Like, if you go and take down a tree, there's some cost to that. How much is it to then replant there?
To replant a tree? The ones we were looking at were the... disease-free Dutch elm guaranteed for 12 years or 14 years at, I think they were, what, 6-footers? I'm not going to say. I can't. Okay. I can't say. A
few $100 for each.
Yeah,
I was going to say about 300 maybe.
Yeah.
Plus the installation.
Again, it depends on, you know, what we put in. Yeah. You know, we're trying to keep with the elm tree. I mean, because the elm is... you know, a nice tree. Well, but there's other people that, you know, come up and say, well, I'd really like a peach tree there.
Well, but you might want to, might want to do a little bit of mixing because that's what caught these towns over the last 150 years as they went.
But it has to be a shade tree because if you actually look into the Mass General Law, there is the tree warden's got almost as much power as the police chief when you get right down to it.
Who's the tree warden?
Jay Miller.
If I may ask a question, if you had a couple of folks working temporary part-time doing mowing in the summer, would that affect your ability to attend more to tree work?
Oh, certainly. Hands down. I mean, there's if I can free up 2 guys 3 days a week, yeah, there's a lot of things I can get done in town.
So that would be a win-win if we...
Oh, certainly, hands
you
down.
You could get projects done that would never get done if you tie those guys
just
up get, on the
they
zero
just get, keep getting postponed.
Right, yeah.
The hidden thing with this tree business, though, is the danger aspect of it, too. Of course, if it's let go to go too long, it's certainly a detrimental thing to pedestrians or cars or wires.
Okay, like to try to keep going through these. I know some of these we could talk more about, but we have a lot to try to get through. On the next line item, licenses, fees, courses, I guess just any particular reasons on the increase. Is it an additional course or additional person or?
Well, actually, we collectively, myself, Mike, and some of the operators were actually utilizing and going to Bay State Roads. They have really great programs. Three of us just went to one on dirt roads the other day and recognized the fact that different techniques that they have that they're utilizing now work compared to what was taught from one operator to the next operator to the next operator. So if the third person that was the operator was giving you bad information, so that is collectively how that has been done here in town over the years. And I do believe, and I don't want to step too far out, but I do believe that if we start instituting some of the things that we learned in this last thing, our maintenance on our dirt roads is going to go down because they're going to be made properly.
Think crowned.
But exactly, think crowned, you know, think superimposed when you come into some of your corners. But the other side of the coin is you got to have material there to work with too. Right. You know, you go through Pine Nook, you're rolling over ledge. So your choice is fill over it or drill it and blast it. Drilling and blasting is extremely expensive. Gravel's a lot cheaper. So,
driven that road plenty of times.
Yeah.
Okay. Basins, sweeping basins.
I'm sorry?
The next line item I have on here is
sweeping basins.
Is there a comma in there?
Yeah.
Sweeping, comma,
basins.
Oh, yeah,
when they go around in the summertime for, you know, fortunately, with their changing over to using all salt on our main roads, and the only place we're really using sand is on our dirt roads. Excuse me. Last year, let me put, 2 years ago, we had, and again, exact numbers I can't tell you, but I'm going to say it was somewhere in the vicinity of 250, 280 hours worth of sweeping time. Last year, when we changed over to all salt, we had, 16, 18 hours worth of sweeping time.
Mm-hmm.
But now our catch basins. Our catch basins, once again, is because we've been frugal over the years. We've not been in and brought the people in to clean our catch basins. Our catch basins are filling up. They're not working properly. Your drainage is not working properly. Streets are starting to flood more. So that is the two things that we utilize that money for, is mm-hmm. to clean the catch basins. And, you know, realistically, you still have dirt here in town. And we always go through just before, what is it, Memorial Day? Mm-hmm. The first one? Yep. Yeah, just before Memorial Day. We go through and everything gets cleaned up. So that way everything looks nice for Memorial Day. And then some areas where we do, other people do utilize sand and it gets dragged onto our road. Now that it's on our road, now legally we have to pick it up, according to DEP. So if you're in Vermont, you can just push it off to the side, but we can't do that here.
Where does it come from?
People just utilizing sand in their own driveways. It gets pulled out onto. You've got some of the businesses that use sand only. Mm-hmm. They don't want to use the salt. So it gets dragged out.
Just incidental.
Incidental stuff. Over just after the railroad tracks, that general area over there, they use a lot of sand.
I see.
And it gets dragged out into the area. And once again, it gets dragged onto our road, we're legally liable to pick it up.
So sweeping is down, but it's still up there a little bit because you're getting caught up on the basins.
Yeah, pretty much. Yep. I mean, it has been 20,000 in the past. We dropped it down to 15, but again, we're starting to pick up on backlog.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of things we're doing right now is just backlog stuff, just trying to keep up, trying to repair, very specifically the next one, where it says culverts.
Mm-hmm.
I'm working on a project right now. By the time we're through, it's going to be probably $150,000, $160,000 plus.
So that was my question. That's a blank line here.
And it has been.
So does that come out of state monies generally?
No. Are you going to get actually, it'll be like this one here, is I'm going to be coming to you guys and saying, it really likes the money. Because realistically, once again, in the past, it's never been funded. You've never had money set off to a side. And again, I don't know how you would set the money off to a side for very specific to culverts. But whether you can consider that a capital expense at some point, and that's, once again, something you need to start looking at. I mean, we have a lot of culverts here in town. And
these are collapsing, you mean?
Yeah, this one's completely failed.
Okay.
And part of the reason why 5 and 10 has been flooding lately is because of this one culvert that's on Mill Village Road on the north side, just below the soccer fields of Deerfield Academy. So we got to the point that we couldn't go any further. Do you want me to even get into this? This culvert right now?
Yes, I would rather not.
Okay.
Just because we have a lot to cover.
All right. Yeah.
If that's okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Mine was a simple question. Are they collapsing?
Does it need to be replaced?
Yeah. And what the problem is,
yes or no.
make a super long story short, when it comes to culverts, you can't just rip out a piece of pipe and throw in a new piece of pipe. That's not how it works anymore. What you have to do is, depending on the size of it, if it's less than 10 feet, then it's not considered a bridge by DOT. If it's anything wider than 10 feet, then now it has to be constructed as a bridge, according to Mass DOT. When you're doing anything that's got to do with wetlands, which obviously it's a perennial stream, so if there's any fish or anything in there, you're not allowed to have a bottom on this. You have to have a three-sided culvert, two sides and a top. The bottom has to be natural stone. It has to have its natural feed. 2 feet of your culvert has to be sunk into the ground, so that way when your aquatic creatures go through, they understand they're in their natural habitat, so they will continually pass through there instead of coming out and going across.
You have to put lights in it too?
Or? Yeah. Okay. Little dotted line in the middle, keeping
LEDs. That's would be good,
but that's all. That's all DEP. Mm-hmm. It's all regulation. I mean, it's stuff that's out of our hands. You know, the theory
15, 20 years ago, hey, you know, we got a problem over here, rip out this piece of pipe, throw in a new piece of pipe, good to go. There's some areas in town you can go ahead and do that. But this particular one over here has been documented by the state in the past. It does have small little fish in it. And so as soon as it does, now it has creature habitation in it. So now once that happens, all of these crossings have to be looked at by DEP. You have to follow their regulations, per se, their guidelines.
So it might be cheaper to close some roads rather than to...
Okay.
Not necessarily.
No, not necessarily, because think about it, because now if we keep that problem there on the north side, this particular one, mm-hmm. if we're the ones that are creating the backup on 5 and 10, now we collectively as a town, now we're going to be on the hook for if anybody gets hurt on 5 and 10, because we're the ones that are not allowing the water to go down. If we're starting to have septic system failures because we're flooding out the backside. There's many, many things. So we're taking care of our problem on our side. If 5 and 10 still floods after this, or they have any problems on Wapping Road or the Candy Kitchen or any of those areas in there, that's completely 110% on the state. Well, the town will have zero.
To the highway superintendent for that section, yep. he doesn't agree.
Well.
Cause he's saying the outflow area is
Oh, it is. It's plugged. But you know what? It's not ours. It's not the town. Right now, we have a problem, the town. We have created, or at this point, not a good flow. We are going to fix our good flow. Once our good flow is fixed, then it's up to the Deerfield Land Trust, because they got two beaver dams on there that's holding back that have to be taken care of. And then the state would have to take care of their little problems right there underneath 5 and 10. So if they take care of that, then there should be no more flooding out there. But what we're doing now is fixing to make sure that we are not held liable, making sure that we are not going to have anybody get hurt in our area, unless, once again, you just want to close the road. But this one here, it still has to be fixed, whether you want to close the road or not. It's got to be fixed.
All right, line painting.
Line painting, white yellow lines going up and down the road.
Yeah,
it's line painting.
How much was expended last year, perhaps?
$9,153.18, and then they come back in again in the spring.
Sure.
So I still haven't finished off my.
So that's the 9,100 and change. From July 1st on for this fiscal year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, can I drop that 2,000?
Sure,
I'll drop a 2,000. And if I run short, then I'll just steal from another account.
Okay.
Is this outside source or is?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Beaver removal. person we utilize, $100 per beaver to pull them out. Multiple issues in different parts of town. And once again, if we don't take care of the beaver problems, then they become roadway problems. Right now, we got a beaver problem up on Hawks Road that we got to take care of because basically it washed out part of the roadway. You know, I'm going to end up having to dump in 40 ton of stone, 35, 40 ton of stone, and put some gravel around it too. So...
That's a good bridge. You can drive through the water.
That's a pipe.
Huh?
That's a pipe.
Going up the hill to Herons?
No.
Way down? Oh.
No. No, this is if you go past the last house on the left-hand side, you go all the way down, and you got the two ponds, and then there's a big 36-inch pipe that goes across the road. Well... That much of the 36-inch pipe is exposed, and you can barely fit around the roadway itself. Technically, right now, it's still wintertime, so that road is still considered closed. Now, to go and fix that, now we're going to have to fix the dirt road to be able to get the dump trucks out there to be able to fix that part of the road. So we almost would, like when we go to fix any of these dirt roads that we work on, we have to start from one area and continue to work to the next. And the only way, because we can't just go to the bad area, because in the wintertime, these roads just take such a pounding. Again, small dirt road, 10 feet wide maybe, ledge all over the place.
Okay.
Maintenance.
Fair enough. I'd like to skip a couple of these. If anyone else would like to come back, they can, and go down to the gas and diesel line items. We've seen some budgets coming across that have reductions for gas costs, just given the price of gas. I understand that we don't want to be taking the change year over year and cutting the budgets that violently, because it is volatile and will move around and can move up just as quickly as down. But we have seen, and I think at least I'd be looking for pretty much almost any fuel line item in most budgets to have some reduction. What are your thoughts on your usages in the past years and kind of where you stand now?
Well, again, excuse me, right now, this was a little bit tough because we weren't doing a lot of plowing this year. Once again, right now, I've expended about $12,000, so I've got about $13,000 left in diesel. We have expended just over $11,000, $12,000 in gasoline. But again, it was a light winter, so we weren't out plowing as much. We weren't out doing the other things as much. And the fuel, I mean, we don't pay pump price. You know, we go through the Franklin County COG because historically the town has thought in the past this is the best way to go ahead and utilize our money of going through a county bid. It's anticipated the county bid was going to be the cheapest way of going. So, once again, I'm just sticking with, I don't want to say status quo, but that seemed to have worked in the past, so that's one of the things we're trying to stick with.
And the numbers for the FY16 gas you'd be purchasing through that method, when would that be known? Like, when do the bids go out for, like, the gas?
April, May?
Yeah. For the FY17, yeah.
FY17, I want to say, like, May.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to have to estimate. And
it's other than the highway department, who else uses the gas or diesel there?
The only other people who use diesel is the South County EMS, and they get charged by the gallon of what they use.
And who does that?
Who does what?
Who does the billing on it?
Right here in Pat Kroll.
Do you have one of those automatic things that you can just punch a card in and automatically credits their account or charges their account?
Yeah, actually, it's not a card. It's a push button, but yeah.
Okay.
Correct. And so that way, at the end of the month, I just go up and I download all the information off the pedestal. The pedestal goes into the computer. From the computer, I'm able to read out who has used what fuel. Depending on how you want it broken down, I can break it down by vehicle. I can break it down by departments. You know, I have a quote-unquote code in there for the police department. I have a code in there for the fire department. In case something happens, like we did a few years ago, where nobody had any gas, nobody was without electricity, everybody was without electricity, at least now we are prepared. So if they need something, they can go, they can get, and we have the ability to back charge to be able to retrieve that money back, the way it stands right now.
Just for clarity's sake, when the South County EMS buys fuel, we just charge them the rate we pay per gallon, correct? Mm-hmm. Or more to the point, they are paying for that fuel directly.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
That portion of our fuel bill gets expensed out through one of their accounts.
Correct.
Right. So we're not really reselling it to them or anything like that.
Yeah. No, technically we're not reselling anything.
We can't resell, right.
Any idea how much they use during a year?
No. Average, probably about 350 gallons a month on average, roughly, ballpark guess.
All right, my next question would be on the highway patch line item.
Historically what they did in the past is, once again, the patch was just kind of put into either materials. This year I wanted to actually break down and know exactly how much money we were putting out in potholes. And I figured this was the easiest way. And going off of what we spent so far this year.
Don't do that.
I know. I'm sorry. I started 2:00 in the morning, so it's a long day.
So far this year, I've gone through just shy of $6,000. And I still have the spring thaw patching that still has to be accomplished.
So where would that come out of this year's budget?
Has been coming out of road materials.
So screw up.
Where you stand on your road materials budget for this year, Kevin?
Road materials. Not too bad. I mean, granted, right now I've got I got like $10,200. But I also know that we just brought in like $6,000 worth of gravel that we know that we're stockpiling up a little bit because we know we're having to go out and hit all these dirt roads. So is it going to be tight when we're all said and done? Yeah, certainly. No doubt. And the other thing I have to be concerned about is I can't bring that down too low because that's the Paul that I'm stealing from to pay Peter. Because last year, there was no line item for patch material.
Right.
So I'm having to take from another account now to subsidize my patch material.
And that's the general road road materials.
Road, right? Materials, correct.
Yeah, okay.
So FY16 road materials is handling road materials and patch.
Correct.
For FY16.
Correct.
And so where do you see the increase in road material expenses such that after moving patch away, you aren't able to reduce the road materials by the amount that you'd been spending on patch?
Well, we took a pounding this spring. I mean, like I said, we just spent like $6,000 worth of materials. I mean, we put... ...62 ton of 1.5-inch stone on steam mill, because cars were getting stuck. It was a combination of the storm and a combination of the frost coming out of the ground. They were just getting buried. Had to use material. People had got to be able to get in and out of their driveway. You have to be able to get the fire trucks in and out, whole nine yards. If the roads can't withstand, then once again, we're going to a liability against the town. You know, I need to have materials to take care of the dirt roads, or we pave them.
Okay.
And if we pave them, then I think supposedly there's a couple here in town I'd love to pave, but legally I can't, which I'm still trying to do a little research into. Something about a scenic byway. Historic scenic byway.
That's right. There was a reason for that up in West Deerfield.
Is that what it was?
Working with a developer who was trying to...
Oh, okay.
Okay, are there particular questions people want to ask about line items before we just start talking about this as a general sense here? Like, kind of bigger picture.
How do they determine that based on dollar volume?
I'm sorry, what?
The cog fee.
Cog fee? Yeah, that's like just kind of been going off of, it's a percentage off of what they've been helping us out with for our biddings when it comes to all of our road materials. Excuse me, I just finished putting together, it's like 16, 17 pages, asking what we feel that we're going to utilize over for FY17. It includes anything from milling of roads, the paving of roads, to geofabrics, to gravel, to stone, all the different types of stone. Your God, what the hell is it?
So there? Franklin Cog goes out and gets bids on all of these.
Correct.
And we can then you can get in and
correct.
Okay, so you know if you need stone of
right.
some sort.
Right. So we go through that, then we know we're getting the best price. Otherwise, then we're going to have to go out, and then we would have to RFP everything. Mm-hmm. So imagine what kind of a administrative nightmare that would be for the town.
Any state money, Kevin, for the roads?
Yeah, Chapter 90 money?
Right, yeah.
Yes.
What does that look like?
Right now?
Increasing, decreasing, yeah.
Well, my understanding is it's being decreased by, well, the whole program is decreased by $100 million. The entire state. So how much we're going to be getting this year, I really don't know.
The understanding in the governor's budget is that, yeah, Chapter 90 road monies are at a $200 million proposed. That's the same level that Deval Patrick had in his last term, or in his last budget. But when coming into office, Governor Patrick also held back an additional $100 million, which Governor Baker was able to release. So we got an extra $100 million at the onset of his administration. That being said, the budget for this year is proposed at $200 million. There's also the potential for a program that would definitely help small towns do repairs to small bridges, culverts, things like that. That's a proposed $50 million program over the course of 5 years, $10 million a year, and it would be a competitive program. So we would have to apply for those funds, and we'd be basically fighting against all the other towns, small towns that might also be eligible. So I'd rather have the $100 million spread out, because then we'd have a better chance of getting something.
Kevin, mm-hmm. Did you need a transfer into this account last year?
Into which one? I'm sorry?
Huh?
I don't believe we did. No.
No.
I could be wrong, but I don't believe we did.
The snow and ice removal budget,
That's a completely separate.
Completely separate. What is it used for? How do you use that?
Snow, ice, and contractors.
What do you mean snow?
I'm sorry. Salt, sand, and contractors is where that money comes in from.
We buy the salt. We buy the sand. And contractors.
And contractors. Plowers.
Pardon?
People that plow.
Yeah. Contractors that we employ in the town here.
Correct.
Okay.
Can we use that for anything else?
I do not believe so, because that's one of those little protected programs that you can't
change that.
You really can't get into it, because it's, and correct me if I'm wrong, but if you were to take this one particular snow and ice, and if you decreased it, you're not allowed to overspend it the next year.
Correct.
You'd have to wait, 2 years before you can bring the level back up to where you think it needs to be. Yep. That's why it's been historically level funded at $83,000 a year for the past however many years.
At least 5 years.
I guess the question is, are there other plowing-related, snow and ice-related expenses that could be in that budget?
Oh,
that
if I can go ahead and pull off my edges and stuff like that, yeah. I'd love to.
Okay.
But I'm basically told that, no, that's not really what it is. It's the sand, the salt, the contractors, in the brine. We also have a, it's like a molasses brine that we use to treat some of our salt when it gets too cold. The salt's only good for so cold, and then after that, then it just doesn't work anymore. We mix it with this brine, and it works a little bit better for a lower temperature. When you go ahead and you spread it out, it spreads out. It's more dense, and it doesn't do the scatter quite as far. But again, I don't want to get too deep into that, because that's its own separate entity here in front of us.
All right. How do people feel, I guess, overall on the highway expense budget?
I would like to take a look at it in some more depth at some point. But, you know, I don't want to take up a whole lot of time in the committee's time. So
2015... He spent almost the whole budget. My feeling from what Kevin's been saying, he's going to be spending the whole budget that he has this year also.
Yeah, no, that would be fine, but we're talking about an increase of 12 or 13%.
But, I mean, also, if you look back at 2014, it was $330,000.
Right.
Well, but you've got to take
that
out of that
snow and ice.
$136,000 that was snow and ice removal and a separate article for street sweeping.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah, or adjustments, whatever the adjustments.
Okay, how about 2013 then?
2013, okay, take out $83,000, so you're down under $200,000.
Ah, damn.
And take out, and I don't know whether the next one, 83 on the, yeah, you've got the figures above. So in 2011, you got $178,000. In 2012, you got $158,000. Don't ask me, I don't know. And $193,000 in 2013. So that's the. we don't have subtotals for 14, 15, and 16. So. And those are the ones that I just wanted to take a good hard look at this.
Yeah, I mean, I feel that there's certainly more things that can or need to be done than we're going to have the money to do this year, mm-hmm. regardless of where this budget works out.
Yeah. Yes.
There's certainly some line items we can talk about, but, you know, I know for myself, at the end of the day, I do rely very much on Kevin, and I think he's doing a very good job to allocate his resources as he sees fit and in the best interest of the town. For me, it is very difficult to look at such a big increase on this line item as important as this is to us. And for me, it sort of introduces a question in my mind, or a question I'd ask you, Kevin, of if we came down to saying, okay, if we look at last year's budget of $226,000, if we're talking about increasing it by X amount of dollars,
mm-hmm.
or buying a new truck this year, which do you want? And I'm not asking you have to choose right now, but I'm right. saying if we're getting to these sort of points, those are the things that I'm starting to think about of, you know, is the town infrastructure lagging behind the highway department machinery, as important as that is also, because, you know, if either one is falling far behind, then that's a problem. How do other people feel similarly, differently?
The only thing I'd like to say about that, I mean, that's a very good point. You know, hypothetically, could I go one more year with the one ton? Sure, certainly can. Just keep in the back of your mind that the capital improvement requested a plan, a mm-hmm. 5-year plan. We gave him a 20-year plan. And basically, it included all of our vehicles. Once you start coming out of rotation, that's when things start backing up. And again, I understand we're trying to bring the numbers down. And if that's what we need to do, we need to do. But every time, for every action, there's a reaction. Mm-hmm. So just keep in the back of your mind, if we take away from here, and then it's going to cost you a little bit more somewhere else. Or, you know, just the price of the vehicle. You know, how much the price of the vehicle going to jump from this year to next year?
I completely.
So just some things to just keep in the back of your mind. You know, can we take away some stuff from the capital improvement? Sure, but
remember also that you run the risk of suffering larger equipment failures if you keep a piece of equipment on the road for longer than it should be. I'm thinking back to the police cruiser that had 100 and something thousand miles on it, and a transmission went out on it. Whether that was in schedule or not, I don't want to address that necessarily. I'm not sure about that. But it does demonstrate that the older and the more used a piece of gear gets, the higher the maintenance cost of it is. So, okay, so don't buy the new truck this year, but you're going to need to increase the maintenance line item because it'll be in for repairs more often.
Absolutely. Those are both good points, and I didn't bring that up flippantly. I understand how important that is, and
yeah.
I am, if anything, like, I'm a huge proponent of long-term capital investments into town machinery and other things. But I guess my question is, if we're not able to come up with the money to have an increase to the extent being requested here, that's a problem also, as you've articulated. So what I'm trying to do is get a sense of how big are each of these problems.
Which one's more important? Realistically, would I like more money? You know, if I had to sit off on the one tons, that way I've got more money for tree, I'd love to. Because and I know this is part of the job, but you have no idea how many times, nights and weekends, I'm anywhere from shopping to the Holyoke Mall, people grab me, hey, my tree, hey, my tree, hey, my tree, hey, this... Hey, and I understand that's part of the job, mm-hmm. but
how about if we buy you a whole bunch of saws, and every time they do, they just pass
them? Sure, hey, it works for me.
The other thing, and
can we redirect the beavers to the?
Sure, yeah, that would work out even better.
Well, we've talked about
drop it on the power lines, and the power company will come down and take it down the rest of the way.
Yeah, they don't train beavers that well. That's not how that works, I don't think. But it's a good idea.
They just block up the roads.
The other thing, and maybe this is pedantic of me, and so I apologize in advance, but the option of an either maintain this operational budget item or maintain this capital request,
mm-hmm.
This is $260,000 for this operational budget out of a $13.6 million overall town budget. I would strongly encourage the Finance Committee to get a holistic picture before making either or cuts, if we can do that.
I think another thing we have to always keep in mind, at least I do, is that, you know, we're breaking down just one part of his budget here into little details.
Absolutely.
And there's other parts to it, but the bigger picture is, as a whole town, is looking at all the departments, administration, fire, police, DPW, schools, libraries, recreation, and trying to remember our responsibility, in my opinion, to the safety and the general welfare of the public, you know. So I'm not stating if this is too much or too little, but I mean, you want to try to stay focused on that. If you cut DPW on materials and equipment and this and that, then you could be jeopardizing roads. If roads don't work, then fire, police, buses, ambulances don't go as well either. So it's just a kind of a theoretical overview of it, but I try to keep that in mind.
I agree with that. I guess I'd just point out that the hard part about this for all of us is nobody's talking about cutting highway expense. We're talking about how much to increase it. And if there are any budgets that have some easy 15% decreases from last year, I'd love to see them from any department, but I haven't seen them.
Have you seen mine yet?
And I'm not arguing that, Dylan.
No, I think we're on the same page. Yeah. It's just that's what's, you know, I think that we do very much value and appreciate what we're doing here and all the budgets that we talk about. And these are going to be difficult decisions. And I've said this each year. I've been kind of focused on town budgets. Every year is going to be the easiest budget we're going to have for a while, however hard it is. I think each year is going to be more difficult. And these choices are going to get even less easy. Right.
I'm not minimizing a thing here.
Yep.
I'm just merely saying
that
at the end of the day,
it's understandable. I think you know, everybody can come in, every department can come in and present some excellent points in that. But I think we as a committee have to take a look at what our responsibilities are too. And we do have the levy of 2.5%. And when you're dealing with budget increases, and we understand, you know, Kevin's trying to do the right thing for his department too, but when you see that 15%, it's very difficult to be able to justify that and turn around and tell the, you know, whether it be the school department, the police department, whatever, no, you can't have anything over 2.5%. Right. You know, so I think when we come to budgets like this, that I agree with Skip that we've got to spend a little additional time with it and try to work through it to see what we can come up with that's fair for everybody, including the taxpayers of the town.
One other issue that we did before was when we had budgets with gasoline and diesel, at times we would try and work with the highway department and say, you know, you got to cut the budget, figure out what you can cut for the budget out of gas and diesel. And when the time comes that you need extra money, then you come to the finance committee for the reserve so we can take it out of there. And that's what we've done when budgets were really increasing a lot. Now the price of gas and oil is really going down a little bit. So I think that's where you could cut. You may be able to cut $3,000 or $4,000 out of each one of those.
Yeah, it could. I mean, I have no idea what the bid's going to come back at.
Right. I know that. Yeah. But what I'm saying is, say, you shorten it, say you cut $4,000 out of each one.
Oh, sure.
And you find that you need money come March, April, May, then you come to the finance committee because that's why we have that budget for unforeseen circumstances. And that, I'd prefer to see you cut something like gas and diesel rather than cutting the tree work. I think the tree work, I agree with you, that should be done. That justifies $12,000 out of the 34, or 14 out of the 34. So if you cut another, say, $8,000 out of gas and diesel, that would drop it back down there to probably closer to 10% instead of 15%.
Yeah, and like I said, there's other areas in here that we can squeak off on. Again, this is, I was told by my bosses, the select board, present what I need to keep my present level of service in anticipation of what my prices on things are going to come up as, you know, what our vendors will rise the prices to. So that is basically what I attempted to do here, is foresee what we're going to try and get done for the year, what gets fixed, this is basically how much it's going to be costing, and then we figure out whether we can afford it or not. And if we can't afford it, then that's when we sit down and we start chopping these numbers down.
Okay.
So, I mean, I'm not steadfast saying, well, I have to have this amount of money and I don't care. That's by no means, that's not where I'm trying to go. This is what I feel that I need to get me through the season, through the year. And again, if we want to reduce, we can reduce. You know, I mean, Skip and I worked really well last year. You know, we sat down one-on-one and we buzzed right through half of this ahead of time. It was great. Dylan and I sat down a couple of days ago and he brought up some of the concerns that he had on some of these, and it was great. So, you know, it's...
Another one I would look at would be the general highway patch. Since that's a new line item this year of 10 grand, I'd drop that back some too. So that's the thing I would ask for is gas, diesel, and the patch to drop back on, but I'd leave the tree work up there. And then that would get us down to, other than tree work, now you're talking probably anywhere from 4 to 6% instead of a 15%.
I mean, one of the things that I would like to take a look at is if we could hire a couple of part-time help during the summer, and you can take some of the existing staff, and you said you've got considerable tree work. Maybe we could actually end up reducing some of the tree work, the cost, and taking it out of our own budget. But that's, you need to work on that before you start pulling numbers out of the air.
I'd really like to address something. I've heard a couple of things happening here, and I want to just point out a couple of things if I can. 2.5% is being thrown out a lot. I appreciate where the intention is coming from.
2.5% is alive and well in this state.
It sure is. Oh, no question, without a doubt, and we're certainly bound by it. But I wanted to. Do you have the revenue sheets in your book? Did I give that to you? The tax levy calculations. If you do,
this one.
It's actually a subset of that. I've got a specific tax levy calculation, which basically is based on an assessor's formula, which allows us to calculate our 2.5% increase. There are a couple of factors. Our levy limit from the prior year, mm-hmm. We add 2.5% to that. We add an estimate from new growth, which we get from the Board of Assessors. We add any override if one was voted in, which there wasn't, and we get a total levy limit. On top of that, we add any debt that gets excluded, and we get a total amount of revenues that we expect to get from straight from taxes. Aside from the debt excluded amounts.
That's not necessarily the amount that we expect to get. That's the maximum that we can levy.
Oh, fair enough. Okay. Aside from the debt exclusion, which, okay, there it is, the debt excluded amount, the 2.5% plus the new growth is a grand total of $302,408.
What are you using for new growth?
I'm using $62,000, which is the amount we got from the assessors.
Okay, they gave us that?
They gave us that.
Last time I talked to them, they were down in the 15 or 20,000 range.
So. I like 62,000 better.
Well, yeah, well...
My point is that if we really want to really start to practice some sort of fiscal, you know, proper apples to apples comparison, that's the amount that our town budget can go up, and while we stay inside Proposition 2.5, is $302,408.
Well, we also get. I mean, we don't know what's going to. Obviously, we don't know what the change is going to be in state aid. So.
Right. Fair enough. State aid can go up or down.
We do.
Fees that we collect can go up and down. The inspection fees can go up or down.
Well, we do. If you look at the local receipts, that one has tended to increase faster than 2.5%. So.
And that's
also,
great.
If we put all that towards our budget for needs here for the different departments, and I don't want to use this term. I'm forced to, I guess. But where does that leave us with free cash? Where does that leave us for capital improvement far as budgets? All of a sudden, don't we reduce that?
Absolutely.
So yeah, we're offset. Yeah. So to approve all the departments and staying within the so-called 2.5 in the increase, you know, What we're actually doing, though, is we're going to be eliminating free cash, and I hate that term, and or capital improvement budget as far as funds for that, which we talked about, or the stabilization fund. So isn't that kind of a little counterproductive to approving the larger over 2.5% on the budgets?
Okay. I guess my point is that if we really want to talk 2.5%, then we're only talking $300,000.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And you're close.
And the school's budget, and I'm not picking on Deerfield Elementary School for those people who are watching at home. The school's budget, they came in at 2.49%. Woo-hoo! Right. Fantastic. Awesome. It was $160,000. It's over half, more than half, three quarters, I think, something like that, of your overall 2.5% increase.
Mm-hmm.
So to hold budgets at 2.5% does not equal staying inside the confines of Proposition 2.5. We've blown past those confines every single year because the 2.5% increase in our tax levy is only, as you very fairly pointed out, one small portion of our revenue picture.
Mm-hmm.
It's a considerable portion, $10 million. But it's two-thirds of it. It's two-thirds of it.
Yes.
There's state aid to consider. There's Chapter 90 to consider. Chapter 70, local revenues, other local receipts, and creative uses of funds that we have had pocketed away.
Okay, so is your point then that we should be considering higher or lower numbers as we're having conversations about budget targets?
My point is that you should actually look at the overall revenue picture of the town, determine what you want to do with that revenue, and start with that. Right now, our revenue numbers, and again, forgive me for referring to this, our revenue numbers are $1.5 million over last year's expected revenues. That includes everything, free cash, local receipts, and the $262,000 of 2.5%.
Say that again.
$1.5 million over last year, our expected revenues.
So I'm shaking my head. I'm saying no, but we'll talk about
that. That includes $1.4 million of free cash.
But we had $1.2 million last year.
That's right.
Last year's revenues are
actually lower than the year before.
Doug and Skip, I'd like to stop this and get back to these budgets. Yeah. We're getting way off track.
Yeah.
I appreciate you're looking to make a point that some people had thrown out 2.5%, and we don't want to get too hung up on numbers. I'm still not entirely clear if it's because you think we should be considering higher or lower, but I do agree with you that we should not get overly conservative about particular numbers, because at the end of the day, this is going to be about prioritizing, or it's going to be about articulating various choices to people at town meeting for them to choose how they would like to allocate and spend the town's money. That's what our job is.
Fair enough. Mm-hmm.
So unless there's anything else, I'd like to move on from highway expense because I do not think we're prepared to vote on it. I'm happy to have someone, and Skip, if you'd like to do it, be the point person.
I'll take a look at it.
To either take in any questions from other people in the Finance Committee and communicate them back and forth with Kevin, if that's what you'd like to do.
Okay. That's fine.
Cool. Kevin, if we need you to come back on this, that's great. And if we can handle it just by getting some answers, we'll certainly be in touch. And it's an iterative process. This is part of the trade-off of trying to do it earlier, is we may have to do another round as we get closer. But I feel that it's still better than the 11th hour things we were doing last year with every department.
Right.
Not because of the departments, but because of the process.
Right.
Okay. The next one I have here is winter snow and ice removal, which we get a good start to. This was not handed out, so it's in our older packet, and the number on this one is 423-5400. Is the account number.
Did it change from last year, 83,000?
Same number, because that's the
423.
That's what I was told, the number we're going to stick with for the next few years. So that way, because if you change this number, that's
430.
Well, we can't bring it down, otherwise we lose the flexibility.
If you bring it up, then you're kind of shooting yourself in the foot.
Right.
Yeah. My personal suggestion would be level fund.
Last year. Yeah, it's just for anybody not already familiar. So this is where if we reduce this line item year over year, then we lose the ability to deficit spend this account, which is a very specific right this account only has within state budgets due to the unpredictable nature of how much snow you're going to have to plow.
And which we've never done, but that's okay.
What we've never done?
We've never overspent.
We did.
Snow and ice?
Last year.
No, we did.
Yeah.
Okay, anyway.
Make a motion we approve this budget at $83,000.
Second approval.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed?
We did a budget transfer. We did a transfer.
That's true.
In January, the Board of Selectmen voted to authorize overspending the account. You transferred the money in May.
It's okay. We still took care of it.
You never appropriated less than was necessary when all was said and done.
No, what I'm saying is that the accountant estimated what we were going to overspend, and we actually paid it in FY15 rather than FY16. That's what the overexpended, that's what the deficit spending is allowed to do, is to pay it off the following
balance
year.
Balance it out in the following fiscal year, correct.
Yeah, okay, and we did. We took care of it.
The end of the year was balanced out.
The same year.
Fair enough.
Okay. Street lighting.
Street lighting, I'm not sure. It must have been either a typo on my end, but I was looking for level fund.
That may have been actually a rough...
What number is that going to?
This is 424,5400 should be the next one.
Just before
35,000?
Yeah, 35,000.
Fair enough.
I never look a gift horse in the mouth.
Anything
related? Make a motion except the $35,000 figure.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, the next one up.
Next year, I'm just going to level fund everything. I'll be there.
This is much easier.
I'll be here about 10 minutes and
yeah.
Home.
So moved.
The next one up is transfer station expense, $433,5400.
All right, that's super long story short. Oh, I'm sorry. Wait till everybody gets there.
This one Kevin handed out tonight. I don't know if it's different from.
It is very different.
It's very different from.
Yeah, extremely different.
Okay.
Handed it out tonight.
Yeah, 0.86% copies of
going up. $1,629 compared to last year. And realistically, where majority of that comes in from is dump stickers. We have, not dump stickers, bags. Price of bags has gone up.
Doesn't have holes in it.
And the only thing I am a little confused about, if you guys actually have it in front of you, when it says the payroll, once again, I'm really not sure how these numbers got put in here, because historically in the past, my general understanding is when budget numbers are put in, it's hundreds of thousands, tens of thousands, thousands, and then hundreds, and then you really don't get into the next two digits. So I came up with 29,322. I would have asked for 29,300 or 29,400. So I really don't know where it came from.
Make a motion we approve transfer station expense at $190,100.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, test well monitoring maintenance. This is, I believe, a new budget item. It's number 439,5800.
Kevin, I got one question for you on that.
Sure.
How much money do we usually spend each year? I know we budget the same amount.
I know last year we took kind of a little bit bigger hit. I want to say last year we spent $85,000 out of the 90.
How much?
$85,000.
Okay.
Everybody have it? If not, I can.
No.
That's right. It's just a single letter.
Realistically, because this has been always part of the transfer station,
mm-hmm.
It was always kind of a take a little out of here to cover this one there.
$439,5800.
So if anyone doesn't have it, the request is for $90,000. That's unchanged from last year. And Kevin said he's estimating coming in at about $85,000. So.
Make a motion we approve this budget at $90,000.
Before we do that, it was my understanding last year or whatever that this item was likely to be reduced or would go away in some period of time. What's the
period of time?
What's it look like down the road? What are we looking at?
Is it the same program that we ran last year?
It's basically the same program. We're still having the same stuff leaching from the transfer station that continually has to be monitored. We did take away one of the areas that had to be monitored all the time down by Melnick's, but they still have to do their seeps. You know, they go through, they take their collections off of the streams. They take them off the streams by where the cows are. They take them out of all the gas wells, out of the other wells that they have. Mm-hmm. We have multiple test wells. And this is taking care of the trash from the past. Now, how long it would be before this would actually become less? You tell me when regulations with DEP and stuff like that will be less, and that will probably be about the time that these will be less.
Starting January 20th of next year.
Okay, perfect.
No, but you don't, basically, for the foreseeable future, you're saying that we're likely to see this.
Yeah, we're stuck with this. Okay. And the only other choice you have is to dig it all out, dig out the transfer station, or dig out the dump.
That ain't worth it.
And then you're still going to have the seepage that's already there in the ground.
Right.
Yeah, you can't get rid of that.
Is it getting any better? Let me put it that way. Are the test numbers coming
back? It's kind of status quo right now.
So the plume isn't...
It really hasn't blown out any further. Yeah. You know, it's still staying the same. A couple times, you know, and it's weird because one month when they go ahead and they do the test, it's high and you go back, you know, and it's like, oh my God, it's really high. So they'll have to go back and do a second test because otherwise we're out of permit. So they go back to do the second test and say, okay, well, we're not really sure why this one spiked out, but you're fine. So, and this is continual through probably as long as everybody in this room is going to live.
So we're not putting any more wells in. We're using the existing wells
Existing wells right now, but they say that they are looking at two, possibly three more wells they'd like to see. They would like to see. It's not been a requirement yet.
Not a requirement. Any idea when?
When they would require it?
Yeah.
When they say we want it.
And when that happens,
it's kind of when you look at the law and it says shall, you know, shall means you will, mm-hmm. or may is So right now we're at may. The shall has not come yet.
So when that comes, we would actually have to pay for additional wells.
Correct.
Okay.
And then the testing.
And then he's going to need more money. So why don't we approve this while we're ahead of the game?
No, I'm not saying.
Either that or we can agree to do the same thing we do with gas and diesel. Take $5,000 out of the budget and say, come back and see us if you need it.
The only question I have on this, Kevin, is now that this is kind of its own thing, can this be used for anything else? This is standalone. This is all.
Yeah, this is standalone. I can't.
Okay, so then I think it's very easy that we can certainly monitor this over FY16 and 17, and as soon as we start to see it changing and Kevin feels comfortable, we can revisit.
Right. If you see it change, it's because there's movement on direction.
Right. So. But again, I mean, they seem to be fairly happy right now, so. And like I said, there's two to three are mays.
Okay. So if you'll move it, I'll second it.
I'll move.
Second.
All right. Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous? Okay. Kevin, I think that was all the ones I had for you.
Cool.
Unless you have something else.
I still got wastewater, but...
Oh, that's right.
That's the only thing I have left.
Okay.
Any of you pay for a sewer bill?
One.
Two. Three.
Okay.
What? What was the question?
If do you pay a sewer bill?
If you're on sewer.
Yeah.
Being a smart ass, I apologize. Why you know what? You have something to tell them?
Do we have sheets on that?
Yeah, you want to talk about sewers?
God knows we have.
Tell the selectmen to start paying their fair share of the sewer bills.
Well, that message got out pretty clear.
Kevin, would you like to discuss sewer now, or would you like to do that later?
It's going on 9 o'clock,
gotcha.
And I can guarantee you that somehow or other this is going to turn
into two and a half hours,
an hour or more, all by itself.
Yep.
Fair enough. Thank you. Thank you for coming in.
I would gladly come back.
Okay.
You guys, good.
You say that tongue in cheek. I hope.
Yeah.
We're good, Kevin. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin.
See you, Kevin.
Thank you, Kevin.
Good night.
Okay, guys, it's 8:50. We've got way more stuff that we're going to do tonight, but I'd like to try to take care of a couple other things before we call it a night. Doug, is there anything pressing and immediate that you'd like to go in, or would you like me to do a few things here?
Were you going to talk about the reserve fund?
I was not, but we can do that tonight. Let's vote a couple of these budgets from Barbara. So there's two budgets from Barbara's office that we had talked about that we were just waiting to get the finalized numbers for. I'd like to bring those back up. One of them is Franklin County Retirement. Let's see what number we had. So I have a revised number from Barbara, what she would be looking for the appropriated amount of $436,669. This is not changing the overall assessment. The discrepancy last time just had to do with what offsets should be put in for South County EMS, the senior center, and wastewater. My feeling then and now is that any offsets come from Barbara's office, and any of those offsetting entities work with Barbara's office, and whatever they have agreed to, then that's what we will take in.
Can you clarify for that, the amount that belongs under appropriated should be what?
I have a number of $436,669.
$436,669?
Yep.
That's an increase of $60,000 over what was there before?
That's right, and that is because of decreases to the South County EMS wastewater treatment plant and senior center.
Do you have those numbers?
I do. For South County, she has $30,000. Which is the bulk of the differential, $5,000 for the senior center, and $25,000 for a wastewater treatment plant.
What number is that?
Sorry, this is 911-5400, Franklin County Regional Retirement. And to the extent that any of those entities in Barbara end up changing the offset numbers, then we'll revote the budget because that's all this is. The bill we get from the retirement trust, and it's just how we're apportioning it.
There yes, we're going to have to get a copy of it.
There it is.
You got it? Good. Yeah, we did you put the new numbers in there?
Not yet, no. This is from before.
It's
3-3-6.
What have you got for numbers again?
The offset numbers, I have $30,000 for South County EMS, $5,000 for South County Senior Center, and $25,000 for wastewater treatment plant. So taking the same 2017 overall gross number of 496,669 and backing out those three offsets gets you to a new appropriation request of 436,669.
And I'm sorry, retirement budget?
Yeah.
Franklin County Regional Retirement.
Only $30,000 offset for South County EMS.
That's what I have.
Right. Which implies they only pay $150,000 in salaries?
Right, something's wrong there.
That can't be right.
What's the percentage?
19%, round figures. It's 18.9 or 19.1 or something like that.
I believe there was some issue of, and again, this is the numbers I got from Barbara. I'll leave it to her to give us how she got to $30,000, but I believe it had to do with including overtime or not, but I don't know the calculations. I was given the numbers.
You include overtime.
I'm sorry?
You don't include
overtime. I believe that they may have done that in the initial calculation on the SCCMS, South County EMS side. But I don't want to speak for either of them because, again, I view this as those entities coming to whatever agreement they come to. And if that number changes again, we'll revote the change as well and filter through the offsets through the relevant budgets.
The only thing that bothers me is the fact that you've got $30,000, $5,000, $25,000, and usually it's closer within $100. Or something, it's not within $5,000.
Yeah, I mean, these are estimates because you're not going to know exactly what the apportionments are going to be. So no matter what we put in here, my understanding is it's going to be off. It's a question of how much. And I think that this current year we had a problem where one of these offset situations is off by tens of thousands of dollars. And the reason was because the offsetting entity used an estimate that was different than what Barbara would have used, and so she was left short money.
What were those numbers again, Dylan? 30,000 on...
Well, you've got two numbers that are...
Doug, I'm happy to put it off, and you can talk to Barbara and come to whatever number you guys come to.
If we're not in basic agreement, let's put it off.
That's fine.
Yeah, agree with that one.
Gentlemen, again, those numbers were 30,000 on SCIMS.
Yep, 5,000 on South County Senior Center and 25,000 on wastewater treatment plant.
Let me actually just try to clarify if I can.
500 makes.
What's that?
5,000 is almost more than the senior center makes.
No, it's not.
There's only two people that work over there.
There are two people that work there.
And their total budget's only $20,000+.
As I remember the senior center budget, it was actually higher than 5,000 was in there. It was the 8,000 that is actually on the original amount here. And I was told that that's verified as correct.
So $8,000 at 19%?
$8,000, that actually is pretty darn close to accurate, assuming you're not including the outreach coordinator, which should be a part-time position anyway. I'm sorry. Actually, thinking about it.
Let's go with Barbara.
You would only count the director's salary. That $8,000 should be plenty for a senior center.
Five. She's got five.
What's that? Oh, five?
Five. Yeah.
That's not enough.
Let's postpone it.
As I begin with this, yeah. This is the numbers up to Barbara. Those are the numbers Barbara gave me. We can certainly ask her to take a look at them again.
And allow me to clarify. Maybe I can make a suggestion that can clarify this. We started putting the offsets in these budgets because prior to this point, we were seeing double appropriation. We were seeing appropriation on the wastewater budget for benefits, but also the same purpose being appropriated for in Barbara's budgets, which is why you wound up with wild free cash at the end of the year and why you had budgets that were climbing so high. Mm-hmm. We attempted to offset it so the expenses for retirement and health insurance, human resources benefits were only being paid for in one place. I completely understand and appreciate where Barbara's coming from, and what I would rather see us do is appropriate the full amount that she sees necessary in her budget, eliminate the offsets, but then eliminate those expenses from South County Senior Center's budget, from the wastewater budget, from South County EMS's budget. That will cost the town money because those three departments are departments where the funds come from someplace other than taxes.
Does that make sense? And in some cases from other towns. So right. I think that's going to be challenging.
Exactly. Right now, if the offset comes from South County EMS, that means 50% of it is being paid for by Sunderland and Whately and not by us.
No, 48%.
Fair enough. Same thing with South County Senior Center. Same thing with wastewater. The money's paid for the human resources, or I'm sorry, HR benefits for the staff is coming from wastewater receipts instead of from taxes.
Let's postpone it, and then we'll.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I just want to make sure that's clear. I completely trust Barb's numbers, but I want to make sure our offsets are there and are accurate. So.
Well, the offsets are Deerfield's share.
All right. I am going to not try to get any more of these budgets done tonight because it's clear that we're not going to be getting them done. Doug, if you would like to bring up the last issue before we leave on the reserve fund account. So we're not going to be deciding this, but at least to socialize it, and we can continue the conversation at a further date.
Reserve fund account, broadly speaking, has been funded at $80,000. As you work to your budgets, as you tell folks to trim your budgets back, as you tell folks to say, don't worry if you're not quite there or if you feel like you're going to spend it too much, come back to the Finance Committee and we can do a transfer. That transfer would come from probably the reserve fund, possibly from free cash if it's certified. So the question I've got is, how much do you want in the reserve fund, whether you want to stick with the $80,000 or whether you want anything more? I'd also like to put it to the Finance Committee, not to answer today, but to give me a sense as to what you're looking for to put away in stabilization, either the general stabilization or a capital stabilization.
Why don't you throw out, and either that or email us, the thoughts that you had. You'd expressed some of those thoughts to me,
yep.
And I didn't write them down, but just so that, but again, it's late, and I don't think this is a good time to discuss them, but if everybody had them, so we could discuss them at the next meeting. How would that be?
Okay. Everybody in the room has spoken in favor of increasing stabilization for capital, so you keep that in mind.
Except me.
Really?
I wasn't here.
Oh.
I had a vision of what you'd say.
All right, so would we like to leave that as Doug will send an email?
I'll send you out with more specific recommendations.
Yeah. And fine. The thoughts behind it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll do.
The last thing I'd like to pass out, so the Frontier budget public presentation is tomorrow night. That's why we had our meeting tonight, so tomorrow. I certainly encourage anyone who can go. I am going to try to be there as well. These are the relevant pages of the budget. I did not print out.
Yep. Which, Frontier?
Yes.
So we should each have one of these?
Yes.
The whole thing?
Yes, the whole thing. Okay. Each get a packet. So it's got the narrative in the front, the changes. Now, again, this is just the last version that I had. I do not know. It may have already changed.
Do you have another packet for Doug?
He can have mine.
No, I don't need it. Thanks.
Nope,
I'll wait till tomorrow.
I've got the original hard copy.
Wait till tomorrow.
Give it to him.
For Doug.
We'll get a hard copy tomorrow.
Yeah, so there'll be a full one. The only pages that I did not print out for you guys are these pages that have like every one, most of which haven't changed. So I didn't print out the 12 pages of that. Everything else you have, just to have a look and hopefully be there tomorrow as part of the discussion.
The budget portion of that meeting starts at 7.
Yes, I believe so.
Eight prior to that at 6.
That's my understanding.
Okay. And Doug, the next select board meeting?
Wednesday.
This Wednesday at 7?
6:30
here. Okay.
Okay. That being passed out, hopefully you guys can make it tomorrow. The next question is our next meeting.
Tomorrow.
For next week, what I'm trying, let's see.
Are you going to go back to Tuesdays?
I'd like to.
Okay.
The challenge we're having right now is getting South County EMS. Unfortunately, Matt Russo travels a fair amount the first half of weeks, and so it's difficult in the next couple of few weeks, I think, to get him in. Obviously, Zach is going to be coming in. I think it makes sense to have somebody from the oversight board come in with him to speak more to the non-operational, more the budgetary side, the oversight board perspective on it. The question is, if we're not able to schedule Matt, I don't think we'll be able to get him. We'll have somebody else. I'm not sure who. So I don't know how much you guys want to try to move around our schedule to try to get Matt in versus just schedule on Tuesdays and whoever we get.
It might not be bad to have someone else from that Prudential Committee coming in.
From the Prudential,
you mean the oversight board?
Oversight board.
Rather than
okay.
That.
All right, well then.
So I don't think that'd be a detriment.
Okay. So then for right now, then why don't we plan for the next couple of weeks to go back to Tuesdays? If something comes up, we need to schedule somebody in. And, you know, the only people we really need to still come in to speak to us for our first time are Mr. Kalashevsky on the inspection budgets, Patty to come in and speak about the two school budgets, and South County EMS. Those are kind of the three big ones left. So we'll try to slot those in for Tuesdays.
Mm-hmm. There will be a public presentation on the South County EMS budget on March 30th, 6:30 p.m., probably at the Whately office building.
It is in
all three towns, boards of selectmen and finance committees have been cordially invited to attend, and it's open to the public.
And it was my understanding that the location of the meeting is selected by the three town administrators?
We tried to determine the place that could hold the most amount of people, and that seemed to work. It was simply offered by Mark Bruhensky and both Sherry Patch and I basically said that sounds fine with us. So,
where are they going to meet?
In Whately.
I'm sorry?
In Whately.
The Whately offices.
The new place.
They can hold more than we hold in here?
They have 4,000 square feet of empty space, so yeah, I think so.
I don't think they have chairs for it all.
That might be another story.
What time is that, Doug?
I believe it's scheduled for 6:30.
6:30?
We're trying to work out all the details.
It has more of a public informational meeting.
It's going to be a very comprehensive informational session on South County EMS. Everything from the history to what's going to happen in the future to the budget and Q&A.
I took it off the email as 7 o'clock.
Ah, very good. 7. Then there you go. You're probably correct.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, that rings a bell. I think
one member of one of the boards of selectmen could not be there before 7, so I think that's why we moved it to 7.
So Dylan, ours will be then next Tuesday at 6:30?
Yes, so we'll be playing for next Tuesday at 6:30, and hopefully see some of you tomorrow at the Frontier thing. As Doug mentioned, there's the South County EMS public hearing later on this month, and we'll just keep marching through these budgets. The hope would be next week to go through a couple more budgets and vote them, and also get another budget overview from Doug with some updates and start to see where we're heading into. Now that we have a revised elementary school budget and some of these other budgets that are coming into focus, I think Doug has a couple of revised budgets in his area as well.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Just want to bring from the personnel board that we will be working on the comprehension. Yeah. We're going in 2 weeks. Collins has our job descriptions, and we should be getting a report back from them within the next couple of weeks.
Okay.
Good.
Okay.
When does the warrant close?
Wednesday.
What?
This week. I believe that's when the Board of Selectmen voted to close it, is Wednesday of this week. The 9th.
The 9th of March?
I believe so.
Yeah. Why? I always thought it was later than that.
I may be off on the date. I'm pretty sure the March 9th is the date that the board
March 9th?
Geez, did they vote to they didn't vote to close it, but I think that's their expectation. There will be a special town meeting planned. I'm working with Peter James. Sorry, names take a minute here to recall. I've been working with Peter James, and he definitely recommended a couple of specific items go on a special town meeting warrant, which would happen, of course, at 6:30 prior to the annual town meeting. So that warrant has not even yet been opened, but that'll stay open probably a little bit longer. So if that means anything.
So what kind of things are you putting on a special?
Peter James actually suggested, I believe, if memory serves, that items related to zoning belong probably on a special instead of on the full meeting, on the annual meeting. But I'm going to coordinate with him to determine what goes where and what items should be on the annual meeting. There's also a couple of items that relate to FY16, the fiscal year we're in, that seem to make more sense to put on the special meeting instead of on the main warrant for next year, for next fiscal year. So,
Have we seen anything from the CPA committee on their request?
No, their deadline for applications was, I think, just last week. So they're now starting to consider the applications they've received.
So how do we address that if the warrant closes Wednesday?
There's already a warrant article. Remember that, okay. You know, it's just the article that's in place. It's a placeholder to address, to expend such funds from the CPA.
Okay, so yeah. There is an article in there for that.
Oh, yeah, all absolutely.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there an article in there also to disband the CPA? Just spend the $2 million we have now that we have nothing to spend it on?
No, not yet.
Save taxes?
Not yet. There's still time. There's still time.
Would we want to consider that? We talked about it before.
Yep.
It would be nice.
Right
to
now, we have $1.9 million in that fund, and the process they have to go through, they have to go through the CPA committee to draw it out. But if we could put an article in to stop the CPA effective July 1st of this coming year, then people wouldn't get billed for the extra money that goes into the slush fund that's not being used.
Do you know how that money could be used? Assuming that happens. I'm just, I don't know.
The CPA committee has to follow the state recommendations,
right,
of what it can be used for.
Oh, right. I understand that.
So they,
I mean to say that if in fact a motion was made and seconded and passed at town meeting to basically stop adopting the practices of the CPA,
yes,
or whatever, folks would not get that extra surcharge on their tax bill.
Right.
But that $1.9 million that's sitting there that's reserved for those
it
uses.
It has to be spent the way it was supposed to be spent.
It still has to be spent away.
Oh.
So it's going to sit there and be waited to be spent for?
Until somebody puts in a request for it.
Okay.
That wouldn't change.
So that money would still exist.
Yeah.
It's being invested according to conservative.
From their taxes going up even more. Why self-assess you more money
when it's not being spent. That's the way I look at it.
It is worth discussing.
That's why I'm discussing it.
Well, I think it...
I brought it up so we could talk about it.
Wouldn't that have to be a Warren article that would come before town meeting?
I said, can we put that on there if this committee wants it? You could stand up there as a finance committee and recommend that.
No, doesn't a citizen have to?
No.
No, the selectman can put it on.
Selectman can put it on?
Well, we talked last week about dropping it to 1%, but you want to wipe it out totally.
Well,
why don't we find out what the state is planning as far as reimbursement schedules, because they might drop it out anyway, which will make it easier to present.
I think the argument would be...
If they close a warrant on Wednesday, I'd rather have something in and not have something in.
I agree with John.
That doesn't preclude changing it to a 1%.
Okay.
Right. You could always pass over if needed.
Right.
But to have something in there would make sense.
It might be worth if you could talk and find out, are we getting ourselves into a...
Well, I don't even know. I'm going to have to do some research to find out if it's even possible to do what you're talking about. And if so, what the mechanism would be.
And the timing for it, based on...
It'd
be to vote to change the... CPA tax rate that's assessed to the town, either to a smaller amount or to rescind it, or to zero.
Mm-hmm.
And
we'll just terminate the program, or to reduce it to some other percentage.
Quarter percent, half percent, whatever.
Yeah. So long as any of those options are available to us, then we can...
And I agree. I think it's difficult to have a strong opinion until we see how the budget's coming together. But again, if they're closing the warrant in 2 days, then... We're sort of not given the chance to see how that's coming together.
As I say, it's better to have it in there. You can always pass over if that's the case.
Call it a placeholder, the same way they do all these other articles.
Exactly.
Okay. Well, then, Doug, could we... Well, actually, is anyone opposed to asking Doug to put a placeholder into the town warrant with an article related to the CPA?
I know that probably I'll get six... immediate shoot downs on it, but I just raised the question because I've never heard of the finance committee proposing something to be on the warrant. Is this normal, or is that more of a just independent residents, or can anybody, including any committee, put something on the warrant?
Well, we're asking the selectmen to put it on there.
That doesn't mean they're going to.
Doesn't mean they're going to. No, but it's.
I mean, I hear what you're all saying, and I'm not fighting it, but I'm just asking a question. Is this...
Okay, well, then let me rephrase it then. No. Is anyone opposed to us asking Doug to request the selectmen that they place it as a placeholder on the town meeting warrant?
Nope.
So trying to get around a very good point raised about procedurally how to do it. So.
Something like to see if the town will vote to reduce the CPA tax rate... Or take any voter votes, therefore, relative thereto, which allows you to reduce it from 3-2, or from 3-1, or
3-0. Rescind
it. I guess the only question is, do you need different language to rescind versus reduce?
I think that's a matter of just wordsmithing the article to allow for that.
Okay.
The article just needs to define the scope of what could happen.
Okay.
To reduce or rescind
the
CPA tax rate.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay.
And I believe there's a lag, right? If that were enacted, it would not be, is it correct? It would not be for FY17, it'd be for FY18. Isn't there a lag when it comes to changing?
I think there was something there, yeah.
Okay.
I have a slight
idea. You have to just vote it and make the effective date.
Okay.
Well, we need to talk to the state and make sure there's not some
we can do it that way.
That's probably got that.
Like I said, that's part of my concern there.
It's going to cost us a whole bunch to buy
it. And then we turn around, we got our town lawyer who can turn around and tell us too.
Well, maybe if he gets a heads up, or she gets a heads up.
CPA's been there. It's been done in other towns. Duxbury voted to reduce it from 3-1%. So that's at least one town. So it's happened. There's precedent.
Okay.
So
1% is better than 3%.
So would you be willing to?
I'll do the research.
Select board.
Well, what I'll do is I'll do the research. I'll see what's possible, and what I'll do is I'll reply to you and.
and through you to everyone else just for your information. But Dylan, if once we get that information, if you would direct me as to whether or not to proceed, or if the general thought is to proceed, then I'll just keep everybody in the loop and I'll present it to the board and see what they say.
I have a question. Could some of that money be used for like a senior center?
Yes. And for renovation of the senior center.
On that?
And for the development of open space and for the streetscape renovation of South Deerfield, for the redevelopment of the Leary lot into parking and a walking park. Mm-hmm. There's a variety of things which the money could be used for,
but
which we just
not,
haven't.
They're not presenting it? Is that what the problem is?
We're not presenting the grant, an application to the CPA to actually make use of the money. And the fact that the limit for the applications is a six-week period during budget season, so it's the busiest time of the year, and getting a getting an application together is very tough. So
that's called job security, Doug.
Is that it? Thanks.
Well, that's good. I'd like to do a little research into that before, because if they can use it for a senior center, it's something that's coming down the line. And that's one way of putting money away for something like that.
Well, when we started pressing the person from the senior center on actual hours and usage of the place, I don't want to throw $1 million at that building for, you know, a dozen people.
That only take care of the basement.
Well, I guess.
Well, it might take care of some of the outside, but it doesn't do anything to the inside.
I'd rather see it be doled
out.
Nothing
wrong with
a
bunch the outside. It's all
projects
brick.
And maybe a piece that goes to them, but they shouldn't.
Doug, let me ask you this question. Has the select board spent time in thinking through some of these potential projects that it may be used for down the line? Because I think for me, there's no communication as what we're going to be using it for. And we have a lot of other things that we need money for very desperately, and we know what they are. That, to me, is where I really start to question why we're keeping this. Now, if somebody is to come forth and talk about what our plan is, then it's something to weigh against.
I know that the CPA funds have very specific uses.
Yes.
That they're governed by rules not only established by the state law, but also by certain federal rules that come into play, particularly when you're talking about housing. Senior housing, low-income housing, things like that, and the rules for doing restoration or renovation of historic buildings or monuments. There are very specific rules that are established by federal, I want to say agencies, I could be wrong about that, that come into play about what is a historic preservation, what kind of building will qualify, what kind of structure will qualify. And the rules for open space are also defined by various organizations at a nationwide level. I am not well versed in it. I can get you more information, though.
Okay.
But I do know that there is a portion of those funds that are in the bank right now that can only be used for specific things, and a lot of it is open space and low income housing.
Okay.
They have it broken down to four different categories.
Correct.
So we got to find out what those four different categories are, and then there's another one for unreserved.
Correct.
So once we do that, once we find out what's available, then we can decide which way to go.
Right.
But at least we want a placeholder in there so that we can discuss it on town meeting floor.
Fair enough.
And I think that, you know, Doug, we had talked about having, as the way we had our initial budget meeting, joint meeting with the select board, I'd like to have another one of those, you know, mm-hmm. 2-3 weeks before town meeting, as not every number is set, but we're getting there. And I think that having this as a placeholder would be a good idea for all of us to take up that issue at that meeting. Mm-hmm. And we may come out with all of us agreeing to keep it as it is. But if we don't have something in there, we won't have a choice. And I think it's a conversation worth having. So I guess that would be my request to the select board as to why we would look for the placeholder, not because we're dead set on doing it, but we want to have the options so we can have the conversation.
Right.
It sounds like there needs to be a conversation anyway around stimulating understanding of the money, so we have more people giving input and pushing them to use some of it, if it makes sense. Or knowing that we got a kitty for low-income housing that we're not going to use for 15 years or whatever the case may be.
I would like to suggest a date for that joint meeting.
Sure.
And I'm not making a joke. April 1st.
It's appropriate.
Sounds like a good idea.
That's a Friday.
I know that you would be able to get a full complement of the Board of Selectmen on that day.
7 o'clock at night?
It could be in the evening if you want it to be.
Or it could be during the day.
It could be mid-afternoon if you want it to be.
Everybody's retired here except for Dylan.
And he's independently employed, isn't he? No, I don't know what he does. I don't know what you do for a living.
Do we think that that's enough time? Do we think that there's too much time between that and town meeting that we'll still have a lot of things we're figuring out by then?
I really hope we have everything figured out by then, but...
He's dreaming.
Okay.
We have it figured out, but it's subject to change all of a sudden, which is what happened last year.
Town meeting happens at 6:30 or 7, which means the budget can change up to about 6:29 p.m. that night.
Mm-hmm. So how do people feel about April 1st, both in terms of them being able to make it and in terms of the placement of that in the timeline of our budget season?
I think so.
I almost think earlier might be a little better.
Earlier?
I mean, April 1st, closer to town meeting.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
To give us time to...
Yeah, or give us time to air some things if we have to.
You mean sooner?
No, that April 1st is appropriate.
Oh, okay, I see. All right. Mm. Fair enough.
Skip?
What time is that meeting that they normally would do?
They have been meeting on those Fridays. They've been meeting in the afternoons, but I could certainly discuss with them and see what they, you know,
okay,
are
so
able to do.
Why don't we loosely pencil in the first?
Okay.
Time, TBD. Maybe we can set that as we get, you know, into next week's meeting.
Yep.
And, but before we assume we're going to end up having a meeting with the general public
at some point.
Like we did last year, you mean?
Yeah.
Oh, you mean a presentation of the budget?
Yes.
I know the board has been talking about that. I think they'd probably be leaning towards having it after the 1st of April, a week or two out.
Before the...
Yeah, so April meeting with you folks on April 1st does make sense, so that a presentation on the budget might happen on April 12th, 13th, 15th, something like that. I don't know what days of the week that would be, but... So, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Anything else? Anyone have a motion to call tonight?
Yes.
Move to adjourn.
Second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.